Ladies, gentlemen, boys and girls, football fans of all ages, this is Marciano Stadium, home of your Brockton Boxers, and today it's a tradition like no other, Thanksgiving Day football, as the Bridgewater Raynhams come to town to face your Brockton Boxers. I'm Mad Dog Matt Nelson, joined alongside a couple of my favorite turkeys, John Luck, Eamon Convey, Nubi Rateau, and Brittany Mahan roaming the sidelines. It's senior day, and thus we're going to send it over to Principal Wolder, who's going to honor all the seniors at Brockton High.
Our cheerleaders, Alana Alexo, Sarah Butler, India Dancy Goodwin, Darshell Desronville, Jessica Ferreira, Taylor Galligan, Megan Oliver, Jessica Picanzo, Victoria Say, Ayerman Soto. From our JROTC, we have Kelvin Vino, Jesus Alvarez Coriano. From Color Guard, we have Ariella Jenkins, Abby Cleaver, Lydia Sinkowitz. From our majorettes, we have Taylor Bennett, Amantha Doherty, Brianna Duty, Kelsey Gallant, and Kate Gonzalez. From our halftime dancers, we have Maya Moran, Kamisha Vital. Those were the captains, and on the team also with them, we have Kiara Jones, Desiree Melendez, Veronica Say, and Julia Thomas. From our band, we have Sancha Alexis, Shania Bunch, Angela Burke, Sandy Chack, Christopher Corto, Alexandra Donnarumo, Paige Eubanks, Brianna Elchami, Samantha Florio, Caroline Golding, Jillian Hand, Isaiah Henry, Aaron Holmgren, Allison Long, Anthony Mansell, Brianna Marnis, Christopher McCaffrey, Andrew Miriam, Christopher Morales, Andrew Petty, Destiny Rodriguez Fitzgerald, Lauren Schubert, Christopher Sheehan, Alexandra Snow, Nicholas Spadia, and Starling Tu. And from our football team, Devel Gomes, Sean King, Dion Amato, Cameron Fowler, Carrie Phoebe, David Dupe, Jose Gonzalez, or Jose Gomes Soto, Kashawn Brown, Peter Barthamy, Matt Caruso, Jordan Marcano, Pride Favors Jr., Joel Montero, Dakeem Simpson, Dominique Simpson, Rui Gonzalez Jr., Jamal Rodriguez, Kingsley Ijodu Dyke, Luckins Bartholomew, Corey Smith, Patrick Gregory, Antonio Rhodes, and Sammy Tavares. Those are our seniors. Thank you, seniors. Go Boxers. And one more from the band, Sterling Termine.
That's a lot of seniors, John.
Good luck next year finding. I mean, that's pretty much your band, your cheerleaders, your entire football team at this point.
Well, Bridgewater-Raynham will be wearing their road all-white jerseys, navy blue stripe down the side, red numbers, red helmets, Brockton High. Their home black jerseys, maroon pants, red numbers, and the maroon helmets with the boxer decal on the side.
And honestly, this is a day that high school athletes look forward to, but it's also a day that some of them dread. You just heard the long list of seniors that were getting read off by the Brockton High School principal. BR also has a lot of seniors themselves, and for some of them, this is the last time they're going to put on pads, they're going to put on a helmet, and they're going to go play organized football. And both coaches made that point evident, along with some of these senior captains, which we'll talk about a little later on. But getting back to the rivalry here between Brockton and BR, this is a very lopsided rivalry at this point. And if you're a senior on Brockton High, you've basically seen all BR victories here. You want to try and buck that trend today.
Well, I mean, we were at the Brockton Boxers' final practice of the year yesterday, and the sentiment was, we're sick of losing to this team. Let's get it going. Let's finish out the year with a win, and let's play like we mean it.
Yeah, and that's really the only thing you can do at this point. I mean, you know, as the playoff format is currently constituted, this game is solely for pride at this point. And that's what both of these teams will play for, and I think in these games we've seen a lot of competition. Again, John, you mentioned the rivalry has been kind of lopsided, and that is the case, but you know, Brockton certainly fired up, and this Bridgewater-Raynham Trojans team is extremely talented.
And honestly, that's the one thing I'm kind of going to be focused on. Just how is this team going to bounce back from the loss they had against King Philip that ended their playoff season 33-28? It's going to be interesting to see whether this offense is going to be down on its luck, the fact that, you know, we're not going to have a chance to play at Gillette Stadium, or if they're going to come out hungry for a victory, hungry for a chance to go to the Thanksgiving dinner with another victory in their hands.
And Coach Biron talked about that very fact after the King Philip game. He said, you know, our playoff chances are over, unfortunately, and he felt bad for the seniors, but he said that they, after the game in the post-game huddle there, you know, at King Philip, said that they have a big game coming up against Brockton on Thanksgiving. It means a lot to the Bridgewater-Raynham Trojans team. And as you said, Mad Dog, when we were at practice yesterday, the guys are fired up. They know it means a lot to the Brockton Boxers as well. And, boys, it should be a knockdown, drag-out affair here this morning. Some morning football here on a lovely Thanksgiving 2016.
Well, it is worth mentioning, with this rivalry comes a very big production. This, of course, is a joint production of Bridgewater Television and Brockton Community Access. There's probably like 25 people on the crew, too many to name because I know I forget somebody.
We almost ran out of donuts this morning. That was kind of scary.
We did.
There's about 10 or 12 left. I had about seven of them on the way up here. So, you know, just a couple left. But just always great to get the band back together again, you know, to get BTV and Brockton Community Access Sports together and do a production on Thanksgiving is just unbelievable. And, you know, shout out the exec producers on both sides and just everybody involved for making it happen, the board on either side. I mean, we appreciate everybody's work. It definitely is a team effort.
Captains meeting at midfield. Of course, one of the Boxers captains, number 14, Matthew Caruso. He was wearing cleats yesterday, but of course he will not be playing today. He broke his collarbone in the Boxers' first round matchup of the MIAA South Sectional Playoffs against the Newton North Tigers. He is done for the year.
And, John, correct me if I'm wrong, but that's one thing the Trojans have not really faced, right? I mean, they have remained relatively healthy through a very difficult playoff run. I mean, that first game was pretty easy against Natick. They rolled, but Wellesley, I mean, 9-0, that was a brutal, brutal game. King Philip, I mean, the score was high, much higher than I think everyone expected. But for those of you guys who were there, I mean, it was a physical game. I mean, those were two manhandling teams. But the Trojans have remained relatively healthy. Brockton's been bit by the injury bug.
Right. The lone exception is James Kurtz. He was injured in the game against St. John's Prep a few weeks ago. Then the following week against Natick, as you talked about. But like you said, this has been a very healthy season for BR. Knock on wood. You see number 26 there, Sean Noel Jr., the running back, the senior running back, playing his last high school football game. And this is a man who's actually leading Division 1A in touchdowns all year. I believe he has 17 coming into this game. But nevertheless, he's going to be a focal point, in my eyes, in this game. And just What kind of holes is the left side of the offensive line going to provide him for running through?
And Mad Dog, for the Boxers, it is get hats on the football. If Sean Noel Jr. or Bryce Shaw is touching the ball, there have to be hats hitting them every single time. Brockton has to bring the physicality and try and take some of those skill position players from BR, at least mentally, out of the game early and often.
Well, one of those impact players for the Boxers, number 52, senior captain Kingsley Ejoku-Dike. He's a big impact middle linebacker. On the offensive side, he lines up as a tight end. He's a big part of this Boxer team.
That's going to be a very important focal point. And when you have a defensive line like Brockton getting tested, like it's going to get tested today, I think that means you're going to have to pay a lot of attention to that second level of defense, your safeties, your defensive backs. Because if I'm Brockton, I don't mind giving up the 5-6 yard gain. That's when Sean Knowles running it for 35, 40 yards. That's going to be the backbreaker for the Boxers today if that happens.
And Mad Dog, on the other side for the Trojans, the Boxers need to be very careful when passing against this BR secondary, because guys like Dan Taylor are ball hawking in the playoffs, looking for more interceptions. Brockton has to be very, very wise and careful. Proceed with caution as to when they throw the ball. We know they like to run the ball. This is going to be two physical running teams. But when they do drop back to pass, the Brockton Boxers do need to be aware of number 21 of the BR Trojans.
Well, last week against Wellesley, it was quite the opposite from anything we've seen from the Brockton Boxers. 209 yards passing, 73 on the ground.
And it's strange to me, because BR played Wellesley, you know, the week before with a 9-0 victory, and then you see Brockton able to, you know, get some offense together, and it'll be a very interesting game to see what transpires.
Well, Brockton receiving the opening kick and
went down to field the ball, but in high school you're down by contact when you give yourself up. Brockton Boxers going to start
with a long field.
Not good field position to open this game.
This is very important for the BR defense. Their defensive line can really buckle down on the offensive line of the opposition, so this is a good chance here for BR to try and get some points very early on, even though it's 2 points.
Well, Brockton will start on their own 3-yard line, looking at a 97-yard field in front of them to start. And Thomas O'Brien had quite the game coming out. He completed 6 of his first 7 passes last game against Wellesley. I formation. The give is to Edmund Kelsey, I believe. And he gets the rock up past the 10 to the 12-yard line. Another give to Kelsey. He's still chugging. He gets up to the 20. So the Boxers quickly almost out of danger, but still within the 20-yard line. Actually, the ball spotted at about the 21.
I like that hurry-up offense there. Even though it's back-to-back running plays, it gives the BR defensive line really a short chance to get their breath back together and get back into formation and get ready for Kelsey to run the ball one more time.
And that's exactly what the Brockton Boxers want to do. I mean, they want to come in, run the ball with some of their horses, as, you know, Coach Colombo has talked about before, and then set up the pass from there. Thomas O'Brien, a fairly gifted passer in a small sample size this season, but it needs to be set up well by the run and then protected in the pocket.
This is Marcano getting up to the 25-yard line. Or rather, it was Edmund Kelsey again. Kelsey, only a junior, he's looking to have a very strong season. He's already scored 5 touchdowns on the year for the Boxers.
And building for a great senior season, you said it, Mad Dog. Edmund Kelsey, if he can remain healthy, one of the tremendous, tremendous athletes here that we have in the Brockton football program. And he, again, as long as he remains healthy, he should be a workhorse during his senior year. And we could see, potentially Kerry Raymond-like play from him.
O'Brien under center, Sonny Okunlola, the tight end, lining up on the left side of the formation.
That was a keeper for O'Brien. Interesting play call there on
first
down.
A little bit of a scrum as number 78 for the Boxers getting into it. That is Corey Smith.
Yeah, going after one of the big boys. against BR. And that's number 85 for the Trojans.
Andrew Rubenskis, I believe.
Yeah, Rubenskis. Yeah, one of the great defenders for this BR team. Certainly one of the leaders, at least physically. And Corey Smith just jacking him up a little bit, just saying happy Thanksgiving.
And that's going to be very important. You talk about rivalry games. You're going to have situations like this. It comes down to the players to figure out, you know, when do we want to let go and when do we want to add a little something on there, because this is a rivalry game. You want to leave your mark, but you also don't want to get a stupid penalty.
O'Brien under center, Divell Gomes and Edmund Kelsey, the two running backs. Give to Kelsey. He goes to the left side. Now he's got enough for a first down. Rather, it looks like Jordan Marcano, who's all the way. He's across the 50. He's got nobody in a clear path to the end zone. The 30, the 20, the 10, the 5. Touchdown, Boxers, coming out with a bang.
Unbelievable. Right off the bat, they feed the beast, Edmund Kelsey, number 33, taking it all the way to the house a number of times during that run. Looked like perhaps, and we're going to get a look at this replay right here, bounces it off left tackle, continues to keep his feet churning. BR, good defense in the middle. Connor Rigo with the missed tackle right at the point of attack, and that is all she wrote. Ladies and gentlemen, Edmund Kelsey with the first score on Thanksgiving Day.
He got through multiple sets of two BR defenders on that play.
I give a lot of credit to Patrick Gregory there, getting the last stop before there was that last hand that was able to stop Kelsey. But this could be quite the day for the Brockton Boxers running back if he gets open lanes like that.
Sammy Tavares knocking the extra point through, and Brockton has a 7-0 lead, driving 97 yards down the field for their first drive of the game and a touchdown on that drive.
And John, you alluded to it, great blocking by the Brockton Boxers offensive line there, opening up amazing holes for Kelsey. He had three straight rushes to start the Thanksgiving offense for the Brockton Boxers. And just keeping the legs churning, and finally another good hole. He gets to that second level, which you mentioned at the beginning of the broadcast, and not able to make the tackle at all with the BR Trojans. Connor Rigo with maybe the best chance to get him once Kelsey got slowed up. Kind of behind his blocker, and Rigo just kind of got turned around, played a little bit too wide on the far side there. You saw him pinwheeling back around, trying to get to Kelsey, to no avail. Kelsey with that breakaway speed, showing you why he's one of the most, if not the single most dangerous player the Brockton Boxers have.
Bridgewater-Raynham, they've yet to come back from a deficit this season, so it's going to be very important for them to try and get something important going here. You don't need a three and out. You don't need to kick the ball from inside your own territory. You need to get some offensive momentum going. If you don't get momentum going on this drive, it's going to be a long day at Marciano Stadium.
Sammy Tavares to kick this one away from his own 40-yard line, high end over end. It falls at about the 19-yard line, bobbled by number four. He picks it up. Number four for the Trojans gets tackled by a gang of Boxers. That was Chad Irvine, the senior running back and linebacker, and he didn't get much.
No, and coming into this offensive drive, it's going to be important, like I said, to get the momentum going, but it's also going to be important to try and give Corey Sullivan, the starting quarterback for the BR Trojan, a chance to get some looks downfield. In the game against King Philip, especially on the blind side, he was getting leveled. I think I counted maybe three or four times he hit the ground very hard, so...
Oh.
With some of these defensive linemen on Brockton, if he gets sandwiched into the ground, it's going to be a very painful day for the Trojan starting quarterback.
I'll tell you what, Corey Sullivan proved himself to be one of the toughest players in MIAA competition against King Philip. They are one of, if not the most physical defense in the area, and they blasted Sullivan a number of times, and he just kept getting right back up.
Right off the bat, the entire Boxer defensive line,
led by Kingsley Ejogu Dike from the linebacker position.
Typically, the Trojans have had the bigger linemen on either side of the ball, but they also have been playing this season in Division 1A. So they've had maybe the advantage in the size competition. But right now, they're taking on a Division 1 team in Brockton. And at first glance, this Brockton defensive front has some size on them.
That was Sean Knoll Jr. getting stuffed for his first carry of the day.
And just a dream start here for the Brockton Boxers on offense and now on defense, stuffing the senior stud on the first play.
Back to pass and complete to number 47, who's across the 30 for a first down for the Trojans. That was Bryce Shaw.
And Jeff Fowler and I having a conversation before the game, and we talked about how the Bridgewater-Raynham Trojans use the passing game almost as an extension of their running game. That was kind of a play you saw right there. Bryce Shaw don't really know what he is. I mean, he's kind of in that H-back mode where he can line up at fullback. He's a great blocker. He's a solid running back, great getting out of the pocket. They line him up in the slot. He comes in motion. I mean, he's basically a Swiss Army knife on offense for BR, and right there showing it out in the flat.
Brockton showing blitz. They send in all three linebackers, and Sean Knoll takes a big hit from Kingsley Ajoku DK. Gain of maybe about two on the play for Knoll.
Well, like I said, this is a very sizable Brockton defensive front, and looking at this, this might not be Sean Knoll's day. This might be a day where you see Bryce Shaw getting a lot of touches here, be it via the ground or in the passing game. But right now, if I'm Dan Pierron, I'm thinking about maybe switching this offensive game plan up a little bit, try and get some more passes in, because once Corey Sullivan has time to pass, he's actually one of the better quarterbacks that I've seen. Completed, I believe, if I remember right, three or four passes against King Philip, but they were passes that kept the Trojans in the game until the final minute of the game.
Well, and I'll tell you what, John, too. I mean, at the end of the game, Corey Sullivan threw a ball that Dan Taylor was darn close to catching that would have not only extended the drive but put them basically in field position to win the game if they chose to kick the field goal. It's always tough because the quarterback is going to get the blame in that for throwing the ball ultimately. But Sullivan just doing the best job that he could to keep the play alive. And he's got a heck of an arm, man. If you give him, like you said, John, give him some time and let Sullivan air it out, he can do it for you.
Well, the atmosphere electric here on Thanksgiving Day. The marching band is going full force right now.
Going nuts. Love it.
They are lit right now.
So lit. It's lit.
You're right over there.
Love it. Love the atmosphere here on Thanksgiving.
Second and 7-4, the Trojans. The pitch out to Knoll, and he cuts to the inside and takes a big hit.
Kingsley.
That was none other than Kingsley Ajoku DK.
Man, he is flying around today, Mad Dog. Flying around. Couple of big hits already early in this first quarter. Kingsley came to play.
Sean Knoll is one of those running backs. He can go off tackle. He actually looks for the contact, but after that hit by DK, he may be thinking twice about lowering that shoulder trying to go off tackle.
Yeah, Noel usually using that low center of gravity to his advantage, able to either bowl people over or kind of move around them. He's going to have to do something else against Kingsley because he is flying up, coming in low, and laying the boom.
That looked like a borderline blindside hit, just the way Kingsley came in and Knoll didn't even see it coming.
Right. Knoll was kind of caught up in sort of that traffic of the blocking, almost in the second level there, really just on the outside. And, Kingsley, you said it, Mad Dog, came out of nowhere and just got blasted.
Well, it's fourth and about four to go for the Trojans. And with a big production come sideline reporters. And our very own Newbie Ratteau is on the sideline with Superintendent of Schools Kathy Smith and Vice Chair of the Brockton School Committee, Tom Minicello. Newbie, what do you got for us?
I'm here with Tom Minicello and Superintendent, Vice Chair and Superintendent. Guys, just an absolutely fantastic atmosphere. Just kind of talk about, being a part of this game back in Brockton and just talk about the rivalry in general.
Well, it's a wonderful rivalry. It's a homecoming of sorts because, as we all know, a lot of people from Brockton have moved to Bridgewater. There's a lot of Brockton families in the visiting stands. But this is a great day because it's all about family. It's about the band. It's about the players. And, it's just wonderful. I wish everyone a happy Thanksgiving today to enjoy with their family and friends.
And I want to say the same. Happy Thanksgiving to all our Brocktonians and their families. I wish them so much well in this holiday season. I want to welcome everybody from Bridgewater-Raynham. And it really is important that we take note that when you look at these young people, they will get together. They'll get together as athletes, as band, as cheerleaders. Many of them might even go on to college together. So it is all about unity and making sure that they have the best possible event that we can have here in Brockton. I think it's snowing.
I think it just did.
It's beginning to look a lot like Christmas.
You got that right, Newbie.
Happy Thanksgiving to everyone.
Thanks a lot, guys. Happy Thanksgiving.
Thank you.
Thanks, Newbie. As the superintendent mentioned, it is, in fact, starting to snow here at Marciano Stadium.
And a great... A great line there from Newbie, too. It is beginning to look a lot like Christmas. Love it. See, this is what we need. Last year, for those of you who remember, Christmas was miserable. It was, like, raining and, like, 58 degrees.
But no shoveling, though. No shoveling
was
always the silver lining.
Right, right. After having, you know, 115-some-odd inches to shovel the winter before, I think it was, you know, it was a nice little break. I still can't believe we made it through that. You know what I mean? It's so much time has passed now that I forget that we had, like, a record snowfall in the last few years. Thank goodness it's nice today. Snowing very lightly and not too chilly, guys. Beautiful Thanksgiving.
O'Brien, quarterback keeper, depending on the spot, will be close to a first down.
58 lost his lid. He's going to have to come out. Connor Donovan, junior offensive and defensive lineman. Helmet came off by rule. He will have to leave the field for a play and come back in.
This is an interesting setup, guys. It is worth mentioning. They're playing 12-minute quarters today.
Yeah, a little bit longer, a little more football action for the folks on Turkey Day. I love it, man. I love football on Thanksgiving. It's one of the best, you know, it's one of the best American traditions, in my opinion.
O'Brien under center. Simpson the back. The end-around give to Sean King has a gain of about 2 yards.
Brian Marano, senior linebacker with the tackle there. Nice job by him in the hole. Sean King kind of coming, busting out around the far side of the offensive line. That could be a difficult play for guys in the second level, linebackers, safeties, and such. Donovan making a nice play there, able to corral King. Kind of got him up high. Sometimes you can risk getting bowled over there.
I think with some of these Brockton running backs, it's going to be important for the second level of this Trojan defense to really stay on their toes, because if you let another running back go right by you, we're talking about a 14-0 game pretty quickly.
Right. And we've seen the breakout ability from Edmund Kelsey already very early in this game, so BR does indeed need to be quite careful.
It was Dominic Simpson yet again on the carry for the Boxers.
Kelsey again on the rush.
Edmund Kelsey.
They're feeding him. They're feeding him. He's hungry, and they're, you know, he's getting some Thanksgiving dinner early here. Like to see that.
Already with 97 yards coming into this drive. He accounted for every single yard on the Boxers' first drive. Give to Dyvell Gomes, who has a first down and a few insurance yards.
Yeah, Edmund Kelsey, unbelievably so. I mean, you know, basically eclipsing 100 yards in the first, roughly in the first drive and one play after. Just an unbelievable day for him already. And now you see the Brockton Boxers giving him, you know, spelling him a little bit. We've seen the end around with Sean King. Now we've seen Dyvell Gomes get in the mix. Gomes, of course, another one of those kind of Swiss Army knife players. He punts. We see him block extremely well. Generally lines up in the fullback. But we see them, you know, split him out. I mean, he catches passes. Very versatile player for the Brockton Boxers.
O'Brien under center. Sonny Okunlola, the lone tight end. And Brockton's going to be forced to call a timeout with the play clock running out.
Actually, that's the end of the first quarter. Time flies when you're having fun on Thanksgiving Day. It's almost like a running clock. But nevertheless, actor and Edmund Kelsey, a 75-yard run. It's 7-0 Boxers. And already on this drive, it looks like they got a pretty good shot getting in the end zone here. But once again, it comes down to the defensive line. It does come down to the defensive line for the BR Trojans. I mean, how many do you put on the line? How many do you send back into the second level? Because it could be like a situation like Brockton facing with the Trojans. If you have too many in that second level, you don't mind giving up the 4 or 5 yard gains, but it's going to be very pertinent for your offense to keep you in the game.
Well, John, we talked about it in the pregame. Brockton, 17 different running backs, it seems like. We've already seen three of them in Edmund Kelsey, Dominic Simpson, Sean King, normally wide receiver, taking the end around carry. The list goes on and on and on for the Brockton Boxers, and this is going to turn into a game, I'll tell you right now, of can the Trojan defense keep up with the never-ending ground attack of the Brockton Boxers?
They will be tested, and they've had a pretty solid playoff run, some difficult competition. But the BR defense, I mean, aside from that first drive, you know, they're starting to stiffen up just a little bit, it appears. But I think, you know, maybe a little, just a little bit of, you know, kind of just worn out coming into this game, perhaps.
This is Edmund Kelsey hurdling a few guys to pick up 6 yards. It'll be second and about 5 to go for the Boxers. About 15 seconds into the second quarter, up over the Trojans 7-0, trying to get a little bit of vengeance here in the Cape Cod Cafe Cup.
Mentioned earlier, it's a 5-1 series at this point in this 10-year deal between Brockton and the Trojans.
O'Brien under center. Gomes and Kelsey, the two backs. Pitch out to Edmund Kelsey. And he goes down in the backfield. It'll be about a 5-yard loss for Edmund Kelsey.
And who other, Mr. John Luck, than Bryce Shaw coming to the rescue there for the BR defense with a huge play, just jacking right through the blocking of the Brockton Boxers, able to find Edmund Kelsey in a pretty good thicket there and bring him down, and or at least hold him up in time for the rest of his team, it seemed, to jump on top.
Dan Bjorn actually has a lot of two-way players. There's Devontae Graves, one of the running backs that's a big part of the game plan offensively for the Trojans. He's one of the linebackers. He's also on the defensive line. But
Dan Taylor,
Bryce Shaw. I mean, there's a lot of two-way players here, which certainly helps out trying to scout what the defense is looking at as you're on offense.
That's a good point. Rubenskis as well, right? Tight end for the offense.
Rubenskis also one of the tight ends for the Trojans that they use once in a while.
Pass intended for Sonny Okunlola, falling incomplete.
I think that was an interesting wrinkle that I think BR used a lot more in the KP game, because I noticed that Rubenskis was in on offense quite a bit more. I think because of the King Philip defense, they really wanted to kind of beef up that offensive line and give a little bit more protection for Corey Sullivan. So you saw Rubenskis, big old 85 defensive end normally for BR, but playing a lot more offense against a bigger KP team.
It's 4th and 9.5 to go for the Boxers, so they will punt this one away. Devel Gomes standing 10 yards back. His kick, a high spiraling kick, and fair catch called for at the 20. And with that, we're going to hear from our other sideline reporter for the day, Brittany Mahan, who's on the BR sideline.
You guys, I talked to Joseph. We're on this side, and he was just explaining to me the leadership by Matt Willis, Brett Dale. He was just explaining that they have brought intensity, courage, and strength to this team, and they really have left a great mark going into the future games next year, and these players are really excited to work with them.
Thanks, Brittany. 1st and 10 for the Trojans from their own 18-yard line. Devel Gomes with a very good punt to pin the Trojans within their own 20.
And guys, leadership very important. I mean, when you graduate a bunch of seniors, like both of these teams kind of stand to do, then you're really talking about, you know, needing to bring those younger kids up and have them fill some of those leadership positions that you might not otherwise have when you have those upperclassmen kind of graduate. So great stuff there by Brittany. And of course, I love that. I love the Thanksgiving message from the Brockton School Committee, and of course, Superintendent Kathy Smith as well, from Mr. Newby. Great job by our sideline reporters.
And just to get back to that point about the leadership, and I mean, this all starts down in your peewees and your midgets football. I mean, for Bridgewater, we have the Bridgewater Badgers. You also have the Raynham Giants. Badgers actually won a couple of Super Bowls this past weekend. There's also one team currently on a 50-game plus winning streak dating back to 2012. So certainly a good pipeline of players for BR. I'm not sure about Brockton what you guys have, but from the BR side, I mean, it's just basically been a steady flow of players coming in, and they seem to find their role pretty quickly in their sophomore and junior year.
I think you would probably find that a lot of kids who play Brockton Boxers football did play maybe middle school football at East, West, North, or South. But I do think it's a very interesting point, John. I think that is one thing that Brockton, you know, should probably take a look at and see if they can fund something like that where they have more of a pipeline and just sort of a funnel system for, you know, younger athletes to get involved. I know I've talked with people around the area. It would benefit all sports and all levels. I mean, you have these kids on the same program. They're all kind of working towards the same goal. They're assuming they're going to live in Brockton and go to Brockton High School. They're then familiar with the coaches. They kind of know the system and the way things work. I think ultimately you see dividends like the BR Trojans have faced, even with realignment, winning two playoff games and then very, very close to making it to the Super Bowl in the third.
Pass complete to number 21 for the Trojans, Dan Taylor.
Yeah, Taylor with a nice catch on the outside. And, man, I know he's trying to make amends for last week. He was so close to catching that ball along the far sidelines, from where their bench was at KP in that fourth quarter. They got a chance. They got the ball back. They had made an incredible run. I think they scored two unanswered touchdowns late in the game to get themselves within one. Just a heartbreaking interception there. Corey Sullivan, I mean, it was fourth down, and he aired it out. He gave Taylor a chance. Taylor went up, looked like he was going to have it initially, but just great defense there from King Philip as they have played all year on their way to the Super Bowl, but a heartbreaking loss for the Trojans nevertheless.
That was actually a catch that actually, well, I should say that was an interception that actually called a catch, just because it looked so close
it
on
did.
The far side of the field, but give credit to BR. That was their third consecutive road game. This is their fourth, but going on the road for three consecutive playoff road matchups, that's certainly a good feat to have for some of these players. But, you know, you go back to that King Philip matchup, and I look at the running backs, and that's where this defensive line for the Trojans, they may be having some flashbacks looking at the running backs today.
Yep.
Kelsey, Simpson, also Gomes a couple times. So, you know, there might be some flashbacks for the BR Trojans going back to a couple weeks ago.
Brockton calling a timeout, 7:37 left to go, and the sun's starting to show its face on this Thanksgiving.
The band's not loud enough, boys. I love it. I love it. You got the directors putting their hands up to their ears. It's Thanksgiving, boys and girls. You got to blast it.
I don't know. You don't want the band too loud nowadays.
Hey, you never know. I mean, people understand. You know, people live in the neighborhood. They understand that it's going to be loud during games, and then, you know, it's not going to be after that. And I see we have one of the houses back here has a little gathering in their backyard, a perfect view of Marciano Stadium. Sean Noel, big run there.
Oh, a big first down for the Trojans, gain of about 10 on the play.
Sean Noel, only 34 yards of offense in the first half against King Philip, looking to try and get something going here. He had over 100 yards of offense in the second half against the Warriors a couple weeks ago.
Yeah, and he's had a tough start. I mean, that's his fourth rush of the day, and we've seen maybe 15 yards or so, and, you know, about 85% of them on that last rush right there. But, again, he is a guy that all it takes, much like Edmund Kelsey, he's a guy who takes one play, one big play to get going, and then it's tough to stop him. Interesting formation there for BR, and it worked to their advantage. And all of a sudden, Sean Noel starting to heat up here for BR. He has back-to-back runs of 10-plus.
Another Trojan first down. That interesting formation. It's kind of a fake pitch-out type deal. And the Bucs defense falling for it just enough to get Noel a first down.
We've seen the Trojans have offensive steps where they pack it all in and you have the three in the backfield. You don't have any receivers split out. That's what happened in the second half against the Warriors in the playoff game. And, I mean, it looks like we're starting to see the same idea here. If you have more people on the offensive line, you're going to open up some more lanes for your running backs.
Yeah, really packing it in.
Give to Noel again. He has stood up, but not after a gain of another 8 yards.
Yeah, gashing them now are the BR Trojans, and Keyshawn Brown doing a good job coming up from his safety position to stick Noel in the hole. But you said it, Mad Dog, not after he ripped off about 8.5.
Second and long two, we'll call it three to go for the Trojans.
And just like that, I mean, we saw Sean Noel three rushes for maybe a yard. And now on this drive, you know, he's stretched his average right back out to about 7.5, 8 yards a carry. It's as easy as it can happen right there. He's got 36 on this drive.
Back to passes. The quarterback throwing across his body, incomplete. That was Corey Sullivan with the incomplete pass.
Yeah, and he was looking for 44 over the middle, Bryce Cohen. senior wide receiver, also one of the linebackers on this team. And yeah, he was cutting across from that tight end position, running a little out route there. Corey Sullivan with the lefty rolling out to his strong side on the far side of the field, and had a chance to complete that pass, but Cohen just couldn't hang on to that one.
Sullivan getting his marching orders from head coach / athletic director Dan Buron. Three back set, no receivers. The pitch out to Sean Knoll. Knoll cutting towards the BR sideline. He is pounded by number 23, Joel Montero.
Yeah, Joel Montero right at the point of attack there, getting up into the body of Sean Noel Jr. and making sure that he was not going to get any extra yards after the contact there.
This is that awkward part of the football field. Do you punt it? Do you go for it on fourth down? It looks like Ambion's going to be going for it here, down 7-0 in the second quarter. Right now you're at the 49. A punt may bring you to around the 5-yard line, or it may be a touchback if you let the ball roll in. So I kind of like this call here, going for it on 4th-and-3. Maybe switch up your offense. I think I saw Sean Noel going off the field, so maybe bring in a receiver, which I do see Bobby Long out there, number 7.
Now it's 4th-and-about-3 to go, and BR is going to call a timeout here. Going to game plan a little bit. The sun coming out, but the lights stay on here at Marciano Stadium.
The electric bill is just going to go through the roof.
Hey, you know what? It's Thanksgiving, so they can figure it out. There's line items in the budget for that somewhere.
It's like the Christmas decorations that go on 3 weeks before Thanksgiving.
Yeah, people are really pushing it. I was seeing Thanksgiving stuff before friggin' Halloween. And then I was seeing I was seeing Thanksgiving stuff before Halloween. And then, like, literally the day after Halloween, I was seeing Christmas stuff. It's like, come on. Like, can we just enjoy the holiday, please? And then people just, you know, people like to look ahead. That's the way of the world.
As Sean Noel Jr. comes back out to the BR Trojans, Devontae Graves goes off. So looks like you do have your running option in there. You also do have a couple receivers that you can throw in there. Maybe a trickery play for an extra couple yards. But nevertheless, a very big play coming up here with 4:27 left in the second quarter.
Well, you've had a lot of success on this drive with the running game. Now Sullivan back to pass, has a little hole. He's going to have a first down. He's across to the 45-yard line with a good spot. It'll be to about the 44 of Brockton.
The blind side for the BR Trojans offensive line has really been an issue over the past few weeks. And you've seen it here, number 79, giving chase, and that might have been an ugly disaster. Corey Sullivan got hit by him, but nevertheless, good awareness trying to see where those lanes are opening up to get the extra couple yards and the first down conversion.
Yeah, if you take your time in the pocket, generally things will break down in the second level. And you said it, John, if you can be patient, if you can continue to look downfield and kind of find those creases, Corey Sullivan demonstrating that to a T right there.
First and 10 for the Trojans from the Boxer 44-yard line. Sullivan gives to Noel. Noel spins off an initial hit and keeps the legs churning for an additional 3 yards. It'll be a second and about, we'll call it 4 to go for the Trojans.
And I think that was Kingsley Ejogudike in the hole there making the initial contact. Sean Noel has been smacked by him a couple of times already. Noel getting the better of him there with the B button spin move.
You're not going to spin off a hit by Kingsley Ejogudike times.
Yeah, exactly. That may call it luck, call it a little bit of skill. You know, we'll split it down the middle, but Sean Noel certainly getting the better of him that time.
3 minutes to go in the second quarter. The Brockton High marching band getting ready for only their fourth halftime show of the year. Sean Noel Jr. cuts upfield, and I believe we'll have another Trojan first down.
That's going to be really close depending on the spot here. And it looks like they are going to be, yep, they're going to wave the chain gang on.
First and 10 for the Trojans. Now from the Boxer 34-yard line.
And Sean Noel really, really starting to heat up here now. And we've seen him rip off a couple consecutive rushes of 10-plus and then now a couple consecutive rushes of five or six plus, and just eating up good chunks of yardage here for BR. More importantly, taking some time off the clock as they try to march down the field and even the score.
Sullivan back to pass. Izoku Dike is in the backfield pressuring, and Sullivan forced to throw this one away.
Yeah, veteran move there by Corey Sullivan. Nothing going on down the field. Good coverage by the Brockton Boxers. The various options for the Trojans receiving down the field, none of them open. Sullivan rolling out to his strong left side, able to throw that one away.
Devontae Graves got away with, looks like, a little bit of a hold on Jigu DK. Try saying that 10 times fast.
Izoku DK.
It's tough.
All right. That's I may get that down by the fourth quarter, but nevertheless, Graves got away with maybe a little bit of a hold, but some good job protecting the offensive line.
Second and 10 for the Trojans. Now about 2 minutes and 10 seconds to go. Brockton hanging on to that 7-0 lead over the Trojans in the seventh edition of the Cape Cod Cafe Bowl. Now
ooh,
the end around and a long pass looking towards the end zone. He's got number 44, and it's off the back of number 3's helmet.
Good D there. Didn't even turn
Dion
his head
Amato.
Around. But Dion Amato able to somehow not turn his head around but
and
get
not
in
draw the
leg.
Penalty.
Absolutely. Great job by Dion Amato. 99 times out of 100 you're going to see a pass interference penalty called there. But Amato did a great job. Got in the way of the pass, but did not make contact with the receiver. And a nice job by Amato.
Might made some contact there on that right shoulder of Bryce Cohen in back of the end zone. But nevertheless, I like that trickery call. On second down, Bobby Long served as a backup this year for Corey Sullivan and the BR Trojans.
Wow, that's a nice wrinkle, because then they bring him in at receiver and they can do that wide receiver pass really at any time. Very nice wrinkle by Coach Biron and his staff.
You see it on the screen. BR 1-for-3 on third down conversions today. Two receiver sets, split receivers for the Trojans. Back to pass to Sullivan. He's pressured. Jumping and throwing, and it's going to fall incomplete. And Sullivan took a massive hit by Kingsley Izoku DK.
Absolutely. With the help of number 10 there, Peter Bartholomew, who has done nothing short of play his tail off since the beginning of the playoffs. And got some more technology up here in the booth. We were going to see if Mad Dog would actually take the leap of faith and play with it. Let me play with the thing. I'll do something with the
right there, Izoku DK.
There you go. There you go, pal. Look at him. He's got the telestrator.
Get the telestrator
that might
going.
Be the
Let's
highlight
go.
Of Matt Nelson's life.
Yeah,
what
right.
We just saw.
Yeah, right. Let me get the highlight of my life going next replay. Man, telestrators are fun.
Izoku DK went down at the line of scrimmage. He tripped over one of the Trojans, got back up, and was able to put a massive hit on Sullivan. Brockton showing blitz. Sullivan back to pass again. Pressured by Barthelme, and he's got a pass complete. And not getting much was the Trojan receiver. I believe that was number 47.
Man. Gamble there by the Bridgewater-Raynham Trojans does not pay off. Great pressure by Brockton. And, man, just unbelievable.
Speaking of unbelievable, Newbie Rateau is on the sideline, Mr. Unbelievable himself.
Thanks, Matt. You forgot to, you know, add six-time award-winning Emmy-nominated director, but those are just numbers and stats. We're not going to worry about that today. But I'm here with Carlito Weaver. Carlito, you know, coaching of the head coach of the freshman football team. But, you know, this has got to bring back some great memories here, Thanksgiving football. What does a player go through on this day, the excitement that goes through a player's mind playing right here in Marciano Stadium during Thanksgiving Day?
On Thanksgiving Day, first of all, happy Thanksgiving, everyone, and may God bless you. Thanksgiving Day is a tradition at Brockton High is unlike any other. A lot of emotions. For these seniors, it's probably some of the last times that they'll ever play football in their career. And there's no other moments that they'll share, you know. You're here, you got your teachers, your family, your loved ones. And, you know, it's an opportunity for you to go out there, represent the city, and carry on a long, long tradition of Brockton Boxer football.
Talk about, it seems like this game has a little more intensity, a little more, I think the rivalry's gone up a little bit, particularly Brockton hasn't won in a few years. Let's talk about, do you feel the emotion, the intensity a little ratchet up a little more in this game?
Oh, of course. You know, again, it's Thanksgiving. It's the seniors' last game. And, you know, Bridgewater-Raynham is a great program. And Brockton High, you know, hasn't come up on the winning side in the past couple of years. But this year, you know, these seniors told themselves that they want to go out on top. Obviously, we didn't have the season that we wanted in terms of our playoff run, but all they can worry about is one game at a time and going out on top. As a senior, all you want to remember is your last game as you came off the field victorious.
Quickly, we don't have much time, but how's the freshman football team look and what type of talent we're going to see here in the next few years?
Oh, we have a bunch of guys. This year, we had about 80 kids come out to the team. About 40 of them have at least a 3.0 GPA or better. You know, I try to instill a lot of academics and hard work and discipline and let them know that it's important that they're students first. And, you know, we have a bunch of running backs, a bunch of big, strong kids who can come up and help contribute to the team next year.
Thanks a lot. Happy Thanksgiving.
Happy Thanksgiving.
Back to you guys.
Thanks. Newbie Carlito Weaver, of course, a member of multiple good playoff runs for the Brockton Boxers back in the days. I believe he was a freshman back in 05, 06 when Brockton made their last run to the MIAA title. Of course, leading the Boxers to the 08 Super Bowl where they fell to BC High at Gillette Stadium.
And you heard him mention the importance of this game, knowing that this is the last time that some of these players are going to be dressing up and going out on the football field. So I think you'll see it in the second half. This is going to be a very interesting second half, just see how hungry both of these teams are to try and get the victory and end the season on a high note.
Looking down at the Brockton sideline, starting quarterback Matt Caruso is wearing full pads in his helmet, speaking of last game dressing up. He does have a broken collarbone. He's only a couple weeks out from surgery. But, you know, Peter Colombo of the Brockton Boxers is a very sentimental guy, and it would not surprise me at all if, should this game get to that point and Brockton goes into victory formation, if Matt Caruso goes out there and is the one to take the knee for the Boxers.
Would be a very interesting call, you know. Sort of a symbolic thing, you know, just to give Caruso that one last moment in the sunshine. But Thomas O'Brien, you know, has really done a good job, started the year after the injury early to Montero. And then, you know, of course, kind of getting injured, Caruso takes the job, and then O'Brien has to come back in when Caruso gets injured. Just a crazy season, and, should it get to that point, it would be a nice nod, I think, to Caruso from head coach Peter Colombo.
Well, it's third and long, third and about 12 for the Boxers. They're going with Tyvell Gomes and Edmund Kelsey. And Kingsley Ejokudike is going to line up right next to the center. O'Brien under center. Give to Edmund Kelsey, cutting back to the inside. Now heading out. He's going to get close to a first down. Still on his feet. He's got a first down across the 50 to the 45. Rumbling, stumbling, bumbling all the way. Tripping up Trojans left and right.
And looks at the coaching staff on the sidelines and just says, keep feeding me, keep feeding me.
This is a great running back. Right after the 35-yard line, he just kept chucking. Doesn't matter the contact. You see one, two, three, four Trojans players, including one going off to the wayside. So a very great run there by Kelsey.
Unbelievable. I mean, and the balance too, John. That's what really gets me, guys, is the balance. These guys are getting hit. They're getting tripped up, and all they do is keep the legs churning. They keep the center of gravity low, keep their balance extremely even, and Edmund Kelsey just making a beautiful run right there out of what could have potentially just been a short game.
More importantly, keep the BR offense off the field, and right there, that was third down. Dan Biron takes a timeout. You could be talking about two consecutive offensive possessions as the Trojans will receive to start off the second half. But nevertheless, a very important moment here, 29 seconds left. Try and get some points on the scoreboard, be it a field goal or a touchdown.
Second and 10 for the Boxers from the Trojan 43-yard line. O'Brien lining up in the shotgun for the first time today. Now we have a timeout called by Bridgewater-Raynham.
Just barely getting it in was head coach Biron, and he is fired up on the far sidelines. Obviously didn't like what he saw out of his defense there. and probably didn't want. Maybe if you're attempting to get the ball back, it is second down, trying to force the Brockton Boxers to punt the ball back to you, maybe give yourself a chance at a Hail Mary, something crazy like that. But Coach Buron obviously fired up about something, called the timeout, called his kids in right away.
And we've seen him do that in the past where after they give up a good 15, 20-yard gain, he'll call timeout, get his defense back under wraps and more composed, and they usually do respond to that, and they usually get back on defense and hold the other team back.
Oh, here we go. The 50-50 raffle about to be picked. I love it. Big tradition here on Thanksgiving. Mr. Gary Leonard, the voice of the Brockton Boxers football team. What a guy.
29 seconds to go. Brockton lining up with three wideouts. Keyshawn, four wideouts, rather. Split to each side. Keyshawn Brown, Sean King. Dakeem Simpson, the man in motion. Now trips to the far side. O'Brien in the shotgun, looking long, over the middle, throwing. He's got Keyshawn Brown, and it's going to be broken up, almost intercepted.
Boy, Bobby Long and number 33. 33 initially with the good coverage there. That's Chris Urbano. And then Bobby Long had a chance at it too, sliding down there. Urbano almost able to keep it up off the turf for a moment. And Long sliding in just too late, and it falls incomplete to the turf here at Marciano Stadium.
That could have been very big for Brockton, maybe knock BR out of the game after giving up a big play like that.
BR will receive the opening kickoff to the second half. 22 seconds left, and Brockton has two more tries at the end zone. Trips to the far side. Sean King, the lone wideout to the boxer sideline. O'Brien back to pass. Screen pass complete to Edmund Kelsey, who is run forward by the Trojan defender, a gain of about three, and an immediate timeout called by Brockton.
And that's not good. Behind that play, Bryce Shaw, number 47, slow to get up, left knee not feeling too hot after that play, and he's really struggling just to move. One of his teammates came over to check on him. Looked like he told him he was all right, but it's either a knee or it may even be a cramp. But Bryce Shaw, man, he is a warrior. I believe his dad is a Marine. Am I correct? I was talking to someone on the sidelines at the Natick game, and they were telling me that his dad, I believe, is in the service, and that he has kind of had his dad sort of help him with some of the training, the intense, like, kind of weight training and, I guess, like, running regimens and things like that. I mean, Bryce Shaw is in perhaps the best shape on the BR team. Partially why he's able to play so many snaps for the Trojans.
Especially at fullback, you take on a lot of weight on top of you because you're in there for those third and short situations, and this would be the second straight year that there's a big injury that does affect the BR Trojans.
Just tough to see, especially on Thanksgiving, and Shaw clearly one of the leaders for this BR Trojans team, and now he has gone to the sidelines with that apparent left knee.
O'Brien back to pass, looking for the end zone over the middle. He's going to overthrow Sean King by about 5 yards. And that leads to a turnover on downs, and BR takes over.
Right, and the Brockton Boxers, I think, were looking for pass interference going down the field. And I believe it was Keyshawn Brown. You saw number four come over to them. We're going to get a look at the replay right here. And, yeah, I don't know where it was in there. But the Brockton Boxers, a number of them, a couple of offensive linemen and Thomas O'Brien kind of pointing down the field after that play. So I'm not sure what they were looking at, but Brockton turning it over right before the half in any case.
6 seconds to go. Be interesting if BR heaves one towards the end zone or whether they just take a knee.
And we're being told that
Brittany Mahan has an update on Bryce Shaw. Brittany, what do you got?
So I just spoke to Bryce Shaw, and he did tweak his ankle in that play, but he said that the coach needs him in the second half, so he's going to rest and then get back on that field.
Boy, and right behind the play, Dan Taylor with a near miraculous one-handed snag. About 40 yards down the field, Taylor working on a number of Brockton Boxers as they were in the prevent formation, and BR taking that Hail Mary shot.
Well, it was holding against the Trojans. That penalty was declined. And so ends the first half. Brockton hanging on, and I mean it, hanging on to a 7-0 lead over the Trojans.
And I think that this score could be even worse. I mean, BR has given up a lot of big games on both sides of the offense. You have your passing game and your running game also with Kelsey. This could very easily be a 14-0 game or even a 21-0 game. The defense really on its toes. And it's going to be very important, that first drive in the second half on offense. What are we going to see? What are we going to see from Bryce Shaw? You heard in that report that coach needs Bryce Shaw in there. So it's going to be very interesting to see how Dan Barron uses that running attack with Bryce Shaw and Sean Knoll, because Knoll's been kept at bay except for a couple of measurable runs.
Well, Eamon, BR's defense came out kind of shocked that Edmund Kelsey was able to run for 97 yards on the opening drive for a Boxer touchdown, but they got a little bit used to it, and they've stopped the Boxers on the last couple of drives.
Yeah, they have. They've, bend but don't break defense. We've seen that a number of times from them now going into the half, and Edmund Kelsey over 100 yards, that's exactly the way they wanted to start, and we'll see if Brockton can continue that, but both teams, very interestingly, starting to take a little bit more shots down the field. I think we got a big second half coming here from Brockton.
Well, speaking of big, it's the annual halftime show battle royale between the Trojan Marching Band and the Boxer Marching Band. And right now we're going to hear from the Bridgewater-Raynham Trojan Marching Band. And then we're going to bring you second half action right after this.
School Signature High School Band. Thank you.
Ladies, gentlemen, boys and girls, football fans of all ages, welcome back into Marciano Stadium for second half action in the 7th annual Cape Cod Cafe Bowl. The Bridgewater-Raynham Trojans, the Brockton Boxers going at it. Brockton coming into the second half with a 7-0 lead over the Trojans, courtesy of a big run by Edmund Kelsey, who on the opening drive rushed for 97 yards down the field for a Boxer touchdown. I'm Mad Dog Matt Nelson. Again, alongside some of my favorite turkeys, John Luck, Eamon Convey, Brittany Mahan, Newby Rateau roaming the sidelines. John, we'll start with you. Brockton had a lot of success on the opening drive since then. BR's really stepped it up.
They have stepped it up on both sides of the ball. There was that one passing opportunity where Corey Sullivan threw it downfield to Bryce Cohen that didn't get called, a pass interference. But nevertheless, I think the big thing coming out here is going to be how is this offense going to look on the first drive, try and create some momentum early on, because if you don't get something going on, it's going to be a long second half.
It sure is, and I spoke to Coach Buron as he was coming out of the tunnel here at Marciano Stadium, and he said that Bryce Shaw has been taped up in the locker room. He said that he's going to try and give it a go, but they're not exactly sure. You know, Coach Buron trying to be positive, but obviously, you know, a little bit more serious than maybe we perhaps first thought.
Again, this is a joint production of Bridgewater Television, Brockton Community Access. Lots of toys in effect today.
Yep.
Big
hey,
broadcast.
We go all out on Turkey Day.
All out. Love it.
But getting back to the injury, it's going to be very interesting because you had that power eye formation where you bunch up everybody in the backfield. Bryce Shaw is usually your fullback, so it's going to be very interesting to see what kind of offense we see early on.
Right, and they run like a max eye almost because they end up having three. It's like an offset eye formation. Bryce Shaw is the fullback. Then you have Sean Noel in the middle, and then we've seen a combination of players at that third tier of running back, and really an interesting formation. And it's been very successful, I think, because Brockton has to account for that third running back. You know, it's just difficult for the Boxers to really be able to figure out who the heck is running the ball. And they've ended up giving it to Sean Noel almost every time, but it's still been an effective play.
Well, number 21 with the run back to the 29-yard line. That was Dan Taylor.
Taylor again, man. He does everything, and he just got shook up on that play right there. I don't know if he just got kind of crunched up there. It looks like he got bent in kind of a weird way. He's holding his right arm down by his side, and boy, if they have lost some steam from Bryce Shaw, and now they have Dan Taylor banged up, this is not a good sign for the Bridgewater Trojans, and for the Brockton Boxers. I mean, it's obviously unfortunate they want to compete against the best players, but it certainly gives them a little bit of an advantage on offense and defense. But right away, here's Shaw. Ball's out, and Brockton recovers it easily right in the middle, number 45 for the Brockton Boxers. Dimitri Drinville. Drinville in the right place at the right time, and not sure who stripped it. I believe it was Kingsley Ejogudike who stripped it away. And, man, what a play for Kingsley. An unbelievable start for the Brockton Boxers, just the way they drew it up. Almost sure it was Kingsley who got it, and then recovering it was Dimitri Drinville. Again, right place, right time.
Talked about that defensive line of Brockton. Good job forcing the fumble there, and up now your defense is back out on its toes.
Sean King, the lone wideout to the far side. Screen pass complete to King, and he cuts upfield, a gain of about, call it three on the play, second and seven.
Rigo and Rubinskis over there on the far side making the play. Rigo, the corner, number 25. Rubinskis, of course, the big boy, number 85, that we've mentioned a number of times. Playing some good defensive end for the Trojans. And Rigo, one of those two very good corners. And Dan Taylor back in the game, so obviously not feeling too much ill effect of that play that he caught on the kickoff.
King, the lone wide out once again to the far side. Stacked line to the right side, and cutting the other way is Edmund Kelsey, who has a gain of about 4 yards. King out, and it is number 56, Marcus Hansen in. A.J. Walker in as well for the Boxers.
Brockton with good starting field position here, looking to take advantage, already up 7-0. Right on cue, a beautiful play for the Trojans. Number 58, knifing into the backfield there, A.J. Walker. 2019, the sophomore. A.J. Walker, defensive lineman, doing a nice job breaking up that play there. And forcing the fourth down for the Brockton Boxers, and we will see. Looks like maybe they are going to get out there, and that's my fault. Connor Donovan, defensive line for the Trojans.
Once again, this is that very interesting part of the field. If you punt it, you're going to deal with a touchback, bring the ball out to a 25, so it may be a moot point at this point for Brockton. Go for it on fourth down. Worst case, BR takes over at maybe the 29, 30-yard line. Nevertheless, it's basically 6-1, half dozen the other at this point.
That's true. It's an awkward field position to be in, certainly, John. And Brockton, likely, you know, this is why they're going for it. But again, I mean, you don't get it. This is a pretty long fourth down. I mean, this is a solid 5 yards, full 5 yards that you're going to have to get. And Brockton, not really a passing team, so they're going to have to get creative here on the offensive end. And maybe just trying to draw them off sides.
O'Brien under center, long count.
And boy, I thought they were going to call a false start there on 45. That was an interesting formation change. Drinville.
Give to Kelsey, who charges up ahead, and I think he's going to be just short.
Yeah. Tough. Well, it looks like they might. That's tough. It's going to be a decent spot. I mean, he was going down and able to reach out there.
And he's going to be marked just shy, and BR takes over.
A little bit of a delay here. Some subs coming in for both sides. Now we see Connor Long split out. Shaw in the backfield. Collins going to go in motion.
Big hit.
Boy, Sean Noel got absolutely lit up there. Slow to get up, and I think we may have a holding penalty on the Trojans and a recovery by Brockton.
Pride favors with a huge hit.
And Keyshawn Brown with the beautiful recovery, two straight fumble recoveries to start the half for Brockton.
Mentioned coming in this game that BR hasn't faced athleticism like the Brockton Boxers this year. They're starting to get a very real dose of reality at this point with a boom laid down on Sean Noel and eventually the fumble.
And I think even with the King Philip game, I mean, they were certainly a talented team, John, but I think you're right. I don't think there was the level of athleticism that this Brockton Boxers team comes to the field with week in and week out. King Philip, a good, solid team, very well coached, actually by the son of one of the legends in Massachusetts football here, just continuing that, I believe it's the Lee family dynasty of coaching. But still, I mean, BR really having some trouble with that athleticism. But a good play here as Kelsey nearly able to get out of that too. And Dan Buron absolutely furious, took the headset off and was 5 or 6 yards on the field, really right next to that play.
At this point, I don't think it's more about the play. I think it's what he's seen so far in this second half, a very, I don't want to say lackadaisical, but very turnover-prone football team, especially on the offensive side of the ball.
You know, I think it would be one thing, I think, if BR was simply giving the football away. I think a good amount of credit for those turnovers is due to the Brockton defenders, who on two straight plays laid absolutely crushing hits on the Trojan player.
Gives to Kelsey again, and he tried to spin, was unsuccessful. Loss of about a yard on the play, and that will bring up a third and about 8 to go for the Boxers.
And John, one thing we've seen from the Trojans all year is that whenever they need a big stop defensively, it seems like they get it. Brockton has all the momentum, two straight fumble recoveries, but what do they have to show for it? I mean, they're back in third and long once again, and we'll see, they're at the same part of the field. I mean, does Colombo make another decision to go for it? I would think so. It's been virtually the same situation. And then you're looking at potentially stopping them on two straight fumble recoveries in your territory. I mean, it's an unbelievable feat for the defense.
Trips to the near side, O'Brien in the shotgun. Complete to Sean King. He picks up a couple of blockers and shoestring tackle. Only able to turn that into a gain of about 3, and the Trojan defense is fired up.
I think King was stalked by Jalen Cundiff and Akeem Simpson on that running play. It looked like he started bumping into a couple guys to the point where he couldn't really find open lane, and good awareness by the BR Trojans defense.
Yeah, absolutely. Brian Marano, one of the seniors on this Trojan team, making a good play in the backfield. And he's just another one of the, another one of the second level guys to step up. I mean, Bryce Shaw has been unbelievable. Dan Taylor has had 3 or 4 interceptions in the playoff run for the Trojans. Rigo has played very, very well and just getting contributions all across the board.
Split receivers and complete. Close to a first down.
Great hit by number 33 there, and awesome pursuit, Chris Urbano.
Jakeem Simpson on the reception for the Boxers. That will be close to a first down. There's no call yet.
And it looks like Urbano just taking his time getting up after that big hit. He might have taken the brunt of that one. That's another thing that we've seen. I mean, BR can be a very physical team when they want to, and they've played with a good amount of physicality today, but Brockton, I think, has shown time and time again to just almost be fearless of contact. I mean, when they are feeling good about their offense and running well, I think you see them play absolutely fearless, and BR is having to give it their all on every play.
The chain gang comes out for an official measurement. And it's going to be a first down for the Boxers.
And a great third down conversion there. That's exactly what you needed. I mean, you were potentially facing another fourth down situation, the first one, what I would consider long. I mean, 4th and 4, 4th and 5. And Brockton able to convert there, keep this drive going. And that is a crucial play here early in the second half, and a good momentum sustainer for the Brockton Boxers.
1st and 10, Brockton. Split receivers, 2 to each side. O'Brien back to pass. plenty of time, and it's going to be broken up, but a flag thrown in at the line of scrimmage.
Kingsley Jogo DK on his knees here. Not sure if that's on him, and it looks like perhaps it will be. He was slow to get up. Not sure if he got beat in the middle there. Brockton getting into this offensive formation here, and they will be faced with a first and 20, guys. And this is not what you wanted after a nice third down conversion. Of course, after having to punt on fourth down in the previous possession. And for those of you joining us a little bit late, those two straight forced fumbles, and subsequent recoveries by the Brockton Boxer defense to start the second half. And a great start here, but Brockton's offense sputtering, and a chance
long
for Sean
pass.
King. Oh, and Bobby Long came up with it, but not sure he was able to drag the toes.
That incomplete.
That was very close to an interception,
boy.
I think.
That was. That was. I would really, really be interested to see that again, because I think Long really was able to get his feet down, but the referees ruled it incomplete. Tough to see down there on the near side. Brockton now second and 20, of course, after that penalty that pushed him back on first down.
So it's a second and 20 now for Brockton. Two receivers split to each side. O'Brien back to pass. He's pressured, ducks around the initial hit, and then shoestring tackle, and it'll be third and 21, a yard loss on the play.
Man, if Thomas O'Brien could have gotten a little bit more time on that Mad Dog. There was a beautiful blitz pickup on the near side here. Edmund Kelsey with the BR Trojans rush off that near side. Kelsey picked it up beautifully. O'Brien at the same time kind of pump faked the defender. Was able to get back towards the middle of the field, but great pursuit by the Trojans defense. And once again, you know, we just continue to talk about BR's defense, and whenever they have needed a play, they continue to get it from this defensive side.
Connor Donovan was in there wreaking havoc. That was the play who Kelsey was trying to block from getting to O'Brien.
O'Brien back to pass yet again. Looking long, deep over the middle. It's going to be intercepted.
That's Taylor once again. And
a late flag thrown in after the play ends. Refs got quite the arm. That flag flew about 25 yards.
Yeah, that was a toss right there. Definitely a former quarterback playing referee nowadays. But yeah, well, this will be interesting to see. I mean, Dan Taylor potentially in a spot where it could be pass interference, but nope, it will be on the offense and an interception to boot. BR ball. Boy, just really a couple of wasted opportunities there, boys. They had to go for it on fourth and five on that awkward area. Unable to convert. They force another fumble. The defense just doing incredible work, and the offense really unable to convert anything. And you see the interception by Dan Taylor. I believe that's his fifth in the last four games. I mean, he has just turned it on at the end of the season when it really counted.
He's become quite the force to deal with in the Trojan secondary, but now you're inside of the 10, right around the 5-yard line. It's going to be very important for this offensive line. Try and keep some of these big name players, including Patrick Gregory, who's gotten to Sullivan a few times and knocked him to the ground. It's going to be very important to see what kind of set we have on the offensive line.
Well, the power of technology, folks, as Bridgewater-Raynham lines up for a first and 10 from the 5.
Nice inside handoff there to Bryce Shaw, working up the middle in the fullback dive.
Well, the power of technology, we come to you, and Newbie Rateau has ventured into the crowd on the Brockton sideline. Newbie, who you got?
All right up here in the Rocky Marciano crowd right here. But I found two players who have a lot of support right here in the stands. Just want to give them a lot of shout out. So I hear Montero. What's the name of this gentleman?
Joel Montero.
Joel Montero, and who else?
Deanna Amato,
guys, we have a lot of passion right here in the stands. Everyone's all fired up. Everyone can't wait. People want a Brockton win, and they're going to make a lot of noise because we have a lot of support here. Guys, can you make some noise? Let people know that we have the Brockton Boxers in the house. Can we make some noise, please? We're going to Disney! We're going to Disney! We're going to Disney! We did it! Hi, Mom!
Well, the first down for the Trojans and a couple of fired up fans.
Newbie knows how to make friends, I think. I think everyone just gravitates towards
him. Yeah, man, absolutely. Newbie, one of the great guys helping out here, and got a sick turkey visor headband thing going. I love it.
Whatever it is, it looks like it could have been made by an elementary school student, but nothing wrong with that.
Hey, you know, just getting a little donation on Turkey Day. We love it.
3:27 left to go in the third quarter. Brockton still hanging on to that 7-0 lead. The scoreboard's been quiet since the opening drive of the game. Sullivan with it, cutting towards the BR sideline. He takes a big hit and has gain of about 3 yards.
The weird thing about this is that BR is typically a second half team. They like to eat up the clock as much as possible. Obviously, this is not one of those days. But typically, Dan Bjorn usually has one of those drives that he gets everything to click together and gets some points on the scoreboard. So this is a very unusual performance by the BR offense.
This is Sean Knoll. He takes a big pop from Ajoku DK, but has another Trojan first down.
Yeah, and Kingsley worse for the wear after that. Sean Noel Junior popping right back up after that one. Kingsley a little bit slow. And, boy, we got number 23.
Joel Montero.
Montero, the hero in the Weymouth game, the Weymouth overtime game early in the season, with the great blocked kick recovery return for nearly 100 yards and a two-point winning score. One of the most exciting plays we've seen in recent memory here on BCA Sports. And Joel Montero getting worked on now from head trainer Jerry Connors on the near side.
Flags thrown, false start on the offense. And with that, we're going to hear from Brittany, who's on the Trojan sideline.
The Trojans ran out of the locker room. They told me that they're not surprised with the scoreboard because they knew that the Brockton team had this potential to do damage today. They said their season record may not have shown that, but they have hidden talent on that team, and those boys are showing their talents today.
Always good to hear that, you know, the Brockton team is well respected by its opponents, and I think the exact same thing can be said of the Bridgewater Trojans team. Nice little report there from Brittany. And it's true, you know, these teams have a lot of respect for one another. John, you touched on the fact that the rivalry is a little lopsided in recent memory in the 10-year history of it, but, you know, Brockton looking to get their first win, somehow not an offsides on that play. But a great run, nevertheless. And I believe that is Bryce Cohen. Nope. Not even close. That was number 13.
Devontae Graves, the running back who actually got a couple touchdowns in the loss to Duxbury in the season opener. He's really come into form here as the third running back on that three-headed running monster that the Trojans typically have.
Yeah, and John, in that MIAA opening round game, Devontae Graves, one of the real bright spots for the BR Trojans, played extremely well alongside Sean Noel. Really a good change of pace with Bryce Shaw in the mix as well. And that three-headed Hydra for the Trojans really just dominating Natick in that first round game and gave them some good momentum going into Wellesley.
Split receivers, a fake pitch, and give to...
Dude, that was Travis Shaw.
Travis Shaw, who is... stood up maybe a gain of about one, depending on the spot.
Actually, like Bryce Shaw.
Yeah, Mad Dog. Dimitri Durinville really starting to make some serious plays here in the last couple of games of the season. Number 45 on the defensive end position here for the Brockton Boxers. Coming to the near side just in the front. Durinville really starting to make some big, big impacts along that defensive front for the Boxers.
Time runs out on the third quarter, and Brockton still with a 7-0 lead over the Bridgewater-Raynham Trojans, hoping to move to 2-5 in this Cape Cod Bowl series. And John, we've been fairly quiet since the opening drive here.
We have, and as I mentioned at halftime, this is easily a score that could have been doubled or even tripled, especially off those two early Trojans turnovers. But give credit to the defense where it's due. They did a good job of forcing O'Brien to make some throws that he didn't want to. But then also on the Brockton side, rushing after Sullivan. And also going back to BR, you have Bryce Shaw, who's starting to click back onto his cylinders here after getting that injury in the second quarter, putting it all out on the line in the second half of this final game of the season.
And this game clearly means a lot to both sides, guys. I mean, it's fairly obvious that, you know, this is an important matchup. I mean, both teams coming in, as we just talked about a few moments ago, really respecting each other, expecting a knockdown, drag-out game, and that's exactly what we have here. Just 7-0 entering the fourth quarter here on this 2016 Thanksgiving. And just a shout-out to everybody, all our viewers, and, you know, everybody in both Bridgewater and the City of Champions, of course, Brockton. Happy Thanksgiving to you and yours. We hope you have had a wonderful and safe holiday. And we're just, you know, we're glad that we can be a part of it. Another big hit. Kingsley Ichogu Dike has just came to play all day long, all game long, and has just been an absolute beast.
Again? Oh, okay.
Could I add the entire New England region to that, as this game is going to be featured on Mike Lynch's Channel 5 show, WCVB.
Love it. Mike Lynch, always a good guy. Always, you know, it seems, coming to Brockton, giving us a shout-out on Thanksgiving. You know, I know some of the other, you know, semi-national TV networks don't necessarily always come to Brockton unless it's something negative. And just good to see some positive attention from Lynchy over there at Channel 5, one of the great guys in TV.
This is Graves with a nice run. He's going to be close to a first down. He lost the ball as he went out of bounds.
Laying out to try and get that first down. And that's just encapsulates what this game means to both teams. Devontae Graves absolutely laying out. And it looks like he is going to be spotted with a good first down here in the effort, sacrificing his body by Graves, number 13, paying off.
Devontae Graves is almost just like Sean Noel. He looks for the contact. He tries to roll off of some contact. There's a game against New Bedford where he was just about to fall to the ground, ended up rolling to his right and going into the end zone for the touchdown. So now that Sean Noel's leaving, it's not exactly like the BR Trojans are going to be very short at the running back depth with Devontae Graves coming back for another season.
Yeah, man, it's one of those things. You know, both teams are looking at good junior running backs that they have. You have Graves on the one side, who's learned from one of the best in Sean Noel, and Edmund Kelsey on the other side, who's learned from, you know, great guys like Kerry Raymond and others.
Coming back to pass, he's got number 44 open, and it's going to fall incomplete. No flags thrown. An excellent breakup there by Keyshawn Brown.
And Keyshawn Brown would tell you it is a no-fly zone around him. He fancies himself quite a safety, and you see it play and play out very much in the Earl Thomas kind of mode. Very good in pass coverage, but also an extremely physical presence. Loves to come up and play the run from his safety position. Normally making 3 to 4 to 5 massive hits per game at least, and then great pass defense on the backside like you saw there. And really on 2 out of 3 plays, you see the spirit of this Thanksgiving game, and despite, you know, much of the negativity towards the playoff format, this game clearly has not lost any of its competitive fire for both teams. It might be a different story if BR was headed to the Super Bowl had they beat KP, I'll tell you that much. But nevertheless, both teams unfortunately knocked out from playoff contention, from Super Bowl contention, and playing here, but still a spirited game and a very good, highly competitive game for both teams. And I'm sure Brockton coaches and fans have to be thrilled with the effort of their team. You know, again, lopsided matchup. They've come out with a tremendous effort. They're still only up one score, and there is a ton of time. There's an eternity left in this game with 9:41 remaining. And, you know, Brockton just has to be pleased with the effort and continue to do the things they have done so well. Play physical defense and continue to execute on offense, get some first downs, and keep this potent BR offense off the field.
Well, it's going to be 4th and about 2 to go, and the Trojans calling a timeout, 9:26 to go, and BR threatening. I think personally, they have to get in the end zone on this drive, or you might as well chalk this up as a win for the Boxers.
Well, as Eamon said, this is still extremely early. It was a 7-0 game. Things can quickly turn. However, as far as the BR Trojans go, typically this is Bryce Shaw territory, a fourth and short to go situation. This is when you hand the ball off to your fullback and he charges through.
You said it, John. I mean, Bryce Shaw, just one of the tremendous weapons that BR can go to. And I would not be surprised at all to see Corey Sullivan turn around quickly and get it to number 47 and see if he can blast through this line, pick up the 2 yards that BR needs to continue this drive and potentially have a chance to tie this game as the fourth quarter is rolling along here.
Fourth and two for the Trojans. One receiver and 3 running backs. Sullivan under center. That's going to be a first down. Plenty of room for Graves.
Devontae Graves with ease. There is, he picks up just about 4 or 5 almost of the needed solid 2.5 yards.
And this is the offensive line setup that the Trojans have used in the past, where they basically pack it in and just run the ball down the field. This is what we saw a couple weeks ago in the second half of that game against the Warriors, where you sacrifice your wide receivers, have them come on as an extra blocker, give Sullivan enough time that he can hand the ball off cleanly and maybe act as an extra blocker, get the extra couple yards.
And if BR is able to go down the field and tie this game, boys, we will remember that conversion and this drive by Graves.
Here we go. He's wide open. He's got a wide open path to the end zone, and the Trojans are on the board.
Unbelievable. And I was just about to say, we'll look back at that conversion and at that play by Graves, the 2 conversions, the laid out one on the far side, the other one on the near side here, but I think we'll remember that massive touchdown run a little more.
That one might have a little more sting to it. But going back to that, it was kind of weird seeing Sean Knoll into motion. Knoll actually came on and defended the spy back for Brockton and acted as an extra blocker that Graves could sort of bounce off of to get the extra clearance on the near side.
Boy, 50-yard touchdown rush there for Devontae Graves. And Sean Noel struggles a bit today. Bryce Shaw banged up there. They look like they're trying to save him a little bit more for defensive purposes, rather, if they can. And stepping right up into the void is Devontae Graves.
The kick is good.
And we have a tie game. Devontae Graves doing the thing. And what else can he ask for? You know, just a tie game late on Thanksgiving. It's just unbelievable. 8:38 remaining in this one in a 7-7 ball game. Thanksgiving 2016.
We're all tied up 7-7, 8.5 minutes to go. Brockton about to receive, assumably, a kickoff.
I'm kind of surprised to see a very low scoring game with what these two teams have as far as the offense goes, especially the running game with Edmund Kelsey. Also, you have Sean Knoll, Devontae Graves. So I'm kind of surprised that this is a 7-7 game, but certainly speaks to the will of the defenses on both sides of the ball.
And both teams with not very many possessions. I think that's partially why you see the 7-7 game. Both two very good defensive teams. John, you mentioned the rushing game for BR. Equaled, if not exceeded. I think Devontae Graves certainly just put BR right back in equality as far as rushing attack goes with the Brockton Boxers today. Edmund Kelsey and Graves doing their thing. 7-7 here as we near the halfway mark in the fourth. And special teams helping out. Number 8 for the Trojans, Marana. We've seen him make a number of plays, both from the linebacker position and now on special teams, John. And Brockton, the Brockton offense is going to have to put something together here. At least go down and try and put themselves in field goal position, but they've gotten some drives together early, and then you've seen the bend but don't break mentality from the Trojans, and they've been able to get Brockton in that awkward area where they almost force the hand of head coach Peter Colombo, make them go for that longer fourth down conversion in an awkward spot that maybe they wouldn't normally do. And that's, you know, the Trojans, I'm sure, looking for that and more on this possession.
Tyvell Gomes spinning off a couple of hits and charging ahead for a gain of about 5.
Gain of
Typically with the BR Trojans defense, this has been an edge-rushing team. You have Rubenskis on the near side, number 85, but now you're starting to form that secondary core with Dan Taylor and Brian Murano. That now you're kind of making quarterbacks think twice. Do I really want to throw it that 5 or 10 yards down the field, knowing that it could be picked off?
Yeah, that is an excellent call, John. And, you know, Dan Taylor, just a ball hawk back there at safety. We've seen him in the corner position a number of times. Rigo, an astute corner in his own right, and O'Brien clearly very hesitant to throw the ball, but here's Kelsey once again.
And Kelsey ran into the ref, who held him up a little bit and now brought down. That could be a horse collar.
Very close to it, Mad Dog, but no laundry on the field.
Looked like Taylor and Rubenskis actually got tangled up, allowing Kelsey to spin off of the two of them to get the extra 10 or 15 yards.
Very big first down for the Brockton Boxers and Edmund Kelsey, who has been rolling so far today.
Roughly 150 yards rushing today and just an unbelievable effort. And just an incredible effort here by Edmund Kelsey after being kind of banged up at the end of that playoff run. DR all over him that time, number 33. Coming over from the corner position, Chris Urbano, another guy who's made crazy amounts of plays this morning and this afternoon.
Well, the atmosphere is electric, and part of that is due to the cheerleaders, the Bridgewater-Raynham Trojan cheerleaders, state champions, and we're going to hear from Brittany Mahan, who is with the cheerleading squad.
You guys, as you know, we are in the city of champions, and we are standing with champions themselves. Sarah and Shannon are the captains, and then we also have our three senior girls over here, 5 seniors in total. So, girls, congratulations for finishing high school. That's awesome.
Thank you so much. Well, go ahead.
Oh, no, it's fine. So, how does it feel? How was going into the competition this year?
This year, each competition we would go in kind of humble and just not knowing how we were going to do because we didn't know our competition that well, but each time we competed, we competed together as a family, and that really helped us because our coach guides us in the right direction. Every time we compete, she's always like, oh, I got you and stuff. So.
It's been 4 years. Both of you girls have been on the team for those 4 years. What has your coach brought to your team from your freshman year to your senior year?
She brought so much just like love and teamwork. Like she taught us like how to be a team, how to be humble, and how to just love each other, like win or lose as a team, and just so much love in this team.
Not only when we compete, we bring it to practice every time, and we just practice how we're going to do in competition, and that just brought us to the victory. So,
as we leave this Thanksgiving game, what message do you want to give to your former girls filling your position?
Well, I would say just every time we compete we're at games, we just like to make it clear to what we are trying to share and show them so that next year we can like tell them what to do.
Just make sure that you always have fun and like, just trying to show everyone else how you think we should look, because if everybody's watching us, you want to like look nice and put together, so that's what we're trying to pass down to them.
Congratulations, girls. Have a wonderful Thanksgiving.
Thank you, too.
Split receivers it's fourth down and about 15, so the Boxers are going to punt it away.
Guys, BR cheerleading, one of the best in the area, without a question.
That's a good punt right there for Divell Gomes, falling at the 9.
Nice return.
Excellent return. Number 21, bringing it all the way up to the 28-yard line.
Taylor, man, he's doing it on special teams, defense, offense. He's got a pick. He's got a couple of great returns. Just an unbelievable individual effort here for number 21, Dan Taylor.
So I want to go back to the third down play where Irvine basically blew up Thomas O'Brien.
Yep.
It seems like after that touchdown by Devontae Graves, it seems like now BR is starting to get back into the positive swing of things. For the first 3 quarters, it looks like this was a team in mourning after getting beaten in the playoffs. Now we're starting to see, after that touchdown, this is a team that's starting to click on all cylinders, which could be dangerous in the final 4:49. With the running game like BR has, you can eat up a lot of clock.
That's an excellent point, John, and BR just really, really struggling in this game and just, you know, tough. And Devontae Greaves really giving them a spark, and now they appear to be back in action. Picking up right where they left off with a nice pass from Sullivan to Cohen. Now Bryce Cohen, number 44, getting involved. They've looked for that exact play a couple of times, John, and it's been on the far side of the field, but they have not been able to complete it. And finally, Sullivan's able to roll out. Still traffic in front of him, but finds Cohen running through that second level with the Brockton High defender trailing him. And just a great catch on the run and a beautiful throw there by Sullivan.
I've said in the past that if Corey Sullivan has enough protection, Corey Sullivan can be a very good quarterback. And we've seen that he can't exactly throw the ball 20 or 25 yards downfield, but all you need at this point, 5, 10 yards, just something to keep the drive going, especially at this stage in the game.
And speaking of Corey Sullivan, he took a big hit from Patrick Gregory, the senior lineman for the Boxers. Gives this one off to Graves. Graves charging up ahead, has a gain of about 6, and he has stepped into the shoes of Sean Knoll just a little bit early.
As I mentioned, Devontae Graves, almost like a Sean Knoll in training. It's just been a steady stream of running backs to go back. Brandon Gallagher, Isaiah Johnson, Isaiah Bell, Sean Knoll, now Devontae Graves. Dan Buren has had this system for his entire tenure at BR. You don't need the flashy, glistening glamours of the catches and the 50-yard touchdown passes. You just need to get the most points on the scoreboard in 44 minutes. It's very simple, and he plays his football team to think that way as well.
And I think the same could be said of the Brockton Boxers, Mad Dog. I mean, they have had a gravy train of running backs in the last 5 or 6 years as well.
This is Knoll, who takes a couple of hits but able to get a first down for the Trojans.
And that is something the Brockton Boxers can ill afford, is to let Sean Noel Jr. get going, especially with 3 minutes left in this game. And BR playing very smart right now, managing the clock, still huddling up, making sure the play calls are completely correct and on point. And they are marching right down the field now. Two straight first down completions on this drive and milking the clock, making sure they try to get themselves in field position to go up late.
Graves starting and stopping, falling across the line of scrimmage for a gain of about 1.
And an underlying X factor at this point, as time continues to tick under 2:45, is BR, for the first time in a long time, they actually have a field goal kicker in George Lampros. So ideally, obviously you want to get the ball in the end zone,
right,
but if you can get the ball to around the 15, you may have a 3-point advantage at that point.
Well, and John, I think we've seen Lampros blast a few. I mean, in the playoffs, we've seen some really good kicks out of him, and you're absolutely right, John. He is a weapon. I would think if you get him to even around the 20, he might be able to give you a halfway decent shot.
Sullivan back to pass. Going short and complete to number 44.
Beautiful.
That is Bryce Cohen,
and
senior wideout.
Yeah, and they have found an exploitative matchup there. Pride favors the linebacker trying to cover up there on Bryce Cohen. And Cohen, I believe, listed as a tight end. He's listed as a receiver, and it shows why. He's able to run those 10 and 11-yard outs and very near a first down once again, and that is a good mismatch that the Trojans have now begun to exploit in this fourth quarter. It took nearly the whole game, but they finally figured it out when it counts.
Third and about a yard and a half to go for the Trojans from the Boxer 37-yard line. 3-back set. And a fumble.
Oh.
The ball is out and still out. I think Brockton has it. Kingsley Ajoku Dike picked it up.
Was it him or was it Pride Favors? It was tough to tell down there, but Brockton looked like they did. Oh, BR got it back. Wow, what a stroke of luck.
That's a good break.
51, John McDermott, the senior, coming up with that ball in a scrum. It looked so clearly like either Kingsley Ajoku Dike or perhaps Pride Favors, two of the linebackers for this boxing team, were easily going to come up with that ball. And it was not to be. Number 51, John McDermott, falling on it and saving the day for BR and continuing this drive. Still some good time left, guys.
Well, Brockton sending in some extra size on this fourth down. Number 70, Josiah Roman, the lineman, coming into the game for Brockton. And that's going to be the game, I think, for the duration of this Cape Cod Bowl, is who can stop the other team's running backs better.
At this point, especially on this drive, it looks like Brockton has had their hands full with that balanced dose of Graves and Knoll. At that point, though, on third down, I don't know if giving the ball off to Graves might have been the best idea, especially with a ball-hungry team like Brockton at this point. At this point, I would go with Sean Knoll as your exclusive ball carrier, especially in the later downs, your third down and fourth down. I understand why you would hand it off, but also I'm not sure if right now would be the best time.
Yeah, I mean, you gotta, you know, you gotta stick with what got you to this point, and that is your bread and butter, your running backs for the Trojans. So, you know, I like the call, but you know, everybody on third down, third and anything more than inches, wants to see a play action pass, you know, with a tight end out or maybe a slant across the middle, something short and quick that Corey Sullivan can just pop up out of the play action movement and then just be able to dump it off for the easy first down completion.
Minute 45 to go in regulation time, all tied up at 7. Sullivan giving the ball to Graves again, and he stood up. I don't think he's got enough.
I don't even think it was close. The first down marker is firmly at the 35-yard line, and he looked like he got stopped right around the 37. 38, maybe. I mean, they're going to spot him halfway in between. They're not even going to measure it. It is a clear turnover on downs, and Brockton with the huge defensive stop. And now they have 98 seconds. They do not, unfortunately, I don't believe, have the luxury of a field goal kicker that they can rely on from really any distance outside of the red zone. Sammy Tavares is a very good kicker in his own right, but on a breezy day and sort of difficult conditions to kick in, I don't really know if Coach Colombo would take a field goal try as opposed to just throwing up a Hail Mary and seeing if you can get lucky at the end.
Two receivers to the near side. Edmund Kelsey, Dakeem Simpson, the end-around handoff to Keyshawn Brown. And Brown has a hole. Oof. And still on his feet. He's got a first down and more twisting around and brought out of bounds. But a flag thrown in right back around the line of scrimmage.
Yeah, and we'll see what that is, Mad Dog. That is right in the area of holding. It was thrown in just above where the line of scrimmage started off. And that flag ending up about the 42-yard line. Let's see what the call is here. Yeah, it's going to be holding on the Brockton Boxers in a tough break after what seemed like a great rush there for Keyshawn Brown, giving the Brockton Boxers some life just about 90 seconds to go in this game, or at least in regulation. We will have overtime here.
We've only seen one overtime game the last few seasons, and that was the game against Weymouth, the second game of this 2016 season.
A thriller.
A thriller, absolutely. It came down to a blocked extra point, which Joel Montero ran back 95 yards for the walk-off 2 points.
Well, and for the maximum drama, Weymouth would have won the game. Am I correct in saying?
Yeah, they would have won the game
with the extra point, and it was blocked. Joel Montero came up flush, nearly 100 yards for the score. For the game-winning two-point score. Unbelievable.
O'Brien under center, two backs, no receivers for the Boxers. O'Brien giving it to Edmund Kelsey. Kelsey getting around a few Trojans, still on his feet all the way across the 40 to the 42. Edmund Kelsey with really great escapability.
And behind the play, Rubenskis getting it into it with Sonny Okolola. And both players obviously feeling a little bit of the heat of the moment there.
These two have been going at it all game. After a few plays, they've been getting a little chippy, and you don't want something like this to decide.
No, not at all.
Especially in the fourth quarter.
Not at all, John. That's a very good point. You want to see that sportsmanship continue through even in the heat of the moment. And Brockton appears to be rolling here a little bit. Kelsey giving him good life with rolling under a minute, 48 to go.
Give to Kelsey, splitting out towards the far side. Still on his feet. He's going to get stood up and maybe gained about one.
And it seems like that's the only option to get Kelsey on the ground. You have to get a guy literally at his feet with good hold of his ankles. We've seen him break probably close to 25 tackles today. I mean, it's been an incredible effort for him. He's nearing in on 200 yards rushing for, I believe, what would be the third time of the season. I know he had a couple of big games early in the year, kind of tailed off, whether to injury and sort of the emergence of Jordan Marcano that we saw.
We haven't heard from Marcano today either.
We have not. Edmund Kelsey has, you know, kind of getting the tick here on Thanksgiving as the senior stablemate. Man, he has shown himself to be quite a horse today. As again, nearing getting very, very close to 200 yards here. And I know he would love to go under over 200 and have another long touchdown rush to give the Brockton Boxers the victory here. So everybody can get on and eat their lovely Thanksgiving dinners all across this beautiful state.
Well, Brockton calling a timeout. And with that, we've got a very big crew. We want to thank each and every one of them. There's a lot more on the Bridgewater side, so we'll let John Luck forget someone on that list. But for the Brockton side, of course, we're headed up by executive producers Mark Lindy, Jeff Fowler on the BTV side, Mike the Postman Simmons, Aaron Tebow, myself, the Mad Dog Matt Nelson, Eamon Showtime Convey, the six-time award-winning director and producer and Emmy-nominated
yep.
Newbie Ratto. I think that wraps it up for the Brockton side. John, take it away.
I mean, unfortunately, we don't have nicknames. BTV, we need to work on the nickname.
You do.
But we
hey,
have
John, there you go. Project for
you. I'll be back next year. We obviously have Jeff and Dick Fowler. We have Mike Moriello directing everything that you see right now. We have Nick Allende on the sideline. We have Scott Olson, Brian Berard in the truck, Jason Pritchard and Mark Bloom. Megan Stanovich also here with us as well. Brad Barnsley returning for Thanksgiving. It's like his one day of work, you know. I mean, it's all
returning
good.
Returning for duty. I love it.
Reporting for duty.
Reporting for duty on Thanksgiving, sir.
I think I covered it all pretty blindly.
Missed one.
I missed one.
Brittany Mahan.
Yeah. Brittany Mahan. She's been working BCA games, so I figured, you know, Mad Dog, that was all you.
Yeah, it was. It was Mad Dog. You fell down on the job. What are you doing?
Way to go,
last
Mad Dog.
Last but certainly not least, doing? Brittany Mahan roaming the BR sideline.
Shout out, you know what, and shout out to all the staff, you know, shout out to everybody involved in both BTV and Brockton Community Access.
Forgot one more.
Who we got?
Jumpin' Jay Miller.
How
on the Brockton
we?
Sideline,
how
braving the elements.
Yep, what a guy. One of the best grips in the game. The best grip going. Steady hands for Jumpin' Jay Miller. Yeah, just a great crew. Big thanks to everybody who's involved, literally everybody. I mean, anyone who is involved in these two organizations and their families and the boards of both and their families as well. Just a great day, a great tradition in Massachusetts, and one that isn't. Edmund Kelsey with a pass.
Back to pass
here.
Looking long, deep. He's got a spiral, and it's going to be intercepted. Number 21, Dan Taylor, his second interception of the game. Now he's returning it. He's at the 25 before he is brought down at the 26.
Oh, boy,
Dimitri
Brockton.
Dorenville with the tackle on Dan Taylor.
Oh, man. They went for it. Edmund Kelsey with the halfback pass, and he got blasted for throwing that ball. Oh, my goodness. He took a hit right up onto the helmet, right in the chops. See him coming off the field here, hands on hips. Boy, he sold out on Thanksgiving to try and complete that pass. Dan Taylor said, no, 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 not in my house. Dan Taylor's second pick of the game. And again, I believe sixth in the last four games, the last four contests, three in the playoffs. And of course, one now, just an unbelievable effort for number 21, Mr. Taylor.
As we said, you're going to make quarterbacks, and well, I guess you're going to make other players think twice about throwing the ball downfield with Dan Taylor, Brian Murano in the backfield. Dan Taylor gets the best of it there. It's going to be very interesting to see if Dan Buron's going to take the knee, go for the overtime, or if he's going to throw caution to the wind at this point. It looks like he's going to go with the latter option.
Well, I don't want to rush things, but there's only 19 seconds left in regulation. The give to Sean Knoll. He is hit at the line of scrimmage, no gain, second and 10. And clock running. BR is going to call a timeout.
Yeah, Sean Noel going back to the bread and butter. Dan Buron, I mean, seems clearly happy to take this game into overtime. You know, I'm sure some of the fans might be getting a little restless, you know,
I mean,
trying to get
home. I'm looking forward to stuffing and turkey here.
Yeah, absolutely. So am I. You know, I love a good overtime game, but maybe the one day a year that we have football, I would say let's not go to overtime. Everybody's trying to get on their way and eat their turkey, stuffing, mashed potatoes, gravy, you know, turducken, and whatever you got.
Six-legged turkey?
Yeah, if you're,
the
you
Madden
know,
special?
If you're a tofurkey kind of person, which...
Oh, what's a tofurkey?
Un-American. Un-American.
Yeah, it's hard for me to trust a person that will eat a tofurkey willingly. You know, sorry to all our vegans out there, but, you know, just a great tradition here.
Now, the question of the day, quick thoughts, two-word answer.
Sweet potato pie or pumpkin pie, Eamon?
Sweet potato pie.
Oh,
John?
Wrong answer. Pumpkin pie.
Well, it's a good thing I'm standing correct between you guys.
See, that's the thing
Sullivan
about Thanksgiving.
Back to pass incomplete and a first down for the Trojans with
Bobby Long.
7 seconds. And Bobby Long with the reception, bringing it all the way to the 45-yard line. And I'd say BR has enough time to run one more play, maybe two if they're quick.
Maybe two if you go to the sidelines with Cohen. But right now, if you're a Brockton defensive player, you're playing in between the numbers. If Cohen gets the ball, tackle him at the numbers. And let's not forget, this is a BR team that has not won a game coming from behind all year long. They were down 7-0. They tied the game after Devontae Graves' run. If they get a win here, be it in the fourth quarter or overtime, going to be quite the way to round out the season.
Yeah, you said it, John. I mean, that's really an unbelievable fact to me is that, you know, BR has struggled so much to come from behind. And I think, really, if you could say anything about their Achilles heel, I think, you know, that's probably it. But otherwise, a very, very successful season for
Trips
the Trojans.
To the near side. Sullivan back to pass, and he's going to throw it incomplete as time expires. So we're headed to OT, boys.
Yeah, we're going to have to put the turkey, mashed potatoes, and sweet potato pie on hold here for a minute. Get this game finished out into overtime, and then then we'll go about our day on Thanksgiving. But always a classic here at the Cape Cod Pizza Bowl.
Well, the MIAA overtime rules are quite complicated. We've seen it once on the Brockton side, but our very own Newbie Ratto is with somebody who knows the ins and outs of MIAA football. Newbie, please explain this to us.
Guys, wow, what a game. Are you fired up? Because I'm fired up. The whole team's fired up. Everyone's fired up. BCA's fired up. BTV's fired up. The Yugoslavia station's fired up. NBC. Everyone's all fired up. But I'm here with Coach Frank. Frank, you're one of the assistant coaches for the freshman football team. What are the rules for overtime?
Rules for overtime is that each team gets a possession. And they can go for the extra point any way they want. They can go for two, they can go for one. What happens is the second time they get a possession, they have to go for 2 points. And that's the way, and then they have to go for two from there on out.
Now, what yard did they start on?
They start on the other team's point, the 20 going in.
Guys, there it is right there. We'll see who wins. It's overtime, baby. Let's go to work.
Well, in that Weymouth game, the only overtime game we saw this season on the Brockton side of things, both teams started at the 10. Brockton had the ball first. They punched it in, went for two, missed. Weymouth took over. They scored a touchdown. Went for the extra point. It was blocked, I believe, by Kingsley Ejoku DK. Joel Montero picked up the garbage and brought it back 95 yards to the house. So the walk-off two-point victory for the Brockton Boxers, who ended up winning that game 14-12 final score. And there will be a coin flip, and all the Brockton captains headed back out. Matt Caruso wearing his full pads and helmet.
At this point, you approach it almost like the opening kickoff. If you get heads or tails, you obviously are going to decline at this point. If I'm the other team, I want to try and figure out what do I need to go for. Do you have the PAT or two-point conversion? Let's trust the field for the coin flip.
Bridgewater-Raynham, you guys are still the visiting team. We're using the same coin, Ivy League coin, tails, heads. Same coin here, Ivy League coin, tails, heads. Bridgewater-Raynham is going to do the same thing we did before. When I flip the coin here, you say heads or tails, and then we'll go through the options. Sound good? Here we go.
Tails.
Coming behind you. Let's see what we got, Mr. Umpire.
Heads.
You've lost the toss. You've won the toss. What do you want to do? You want to go on defense.
Brockton has won the toss. They want you to go on defense.
What end do you guys want to choose to set the field? Which way do you want to go? Coach. Okay.
Bridgewater-Raynham will start on offense.
Jack Hill,
go here. Let's go offensive line. It's a push.
Let's go.
Brockton won the toss, electing to ball to the Trojans first.
Like I said, I like that decision. If you get the touchdown and you get the PAT at that point, then if Brockton gets the touchdown on the ensuing possession, do you go for the two or do you try and go for the double overtime? But on the offense side of the ball for the BR Trojans, now you're staring at a Brockton defense that's going to be buckled up a little more. You don't have that second tier defense. You're going to have a couple extra players on the defensive line, so I think this is where your Bryce Cohens, your Bryce Shaw really come into play here as crucial offensive players.
So the Trojans will have the ball at the 10-yard line.
Yeah, the playoff format rules, it's interesting, it's weird, but I like it. It definitely breeds some excitement in the stands. I mean, you basically are forced to go for crazy plays.
Sullivan, the end around give to Sean Knoll, who is stopped at the 6, second and goal to go for the Trojans.
Good job staying at home there by the Brockton Boxers defense. A lot of movement there. Kind of a fake end around, and then Sean Noel comes back through to take the ball from Corey Sullivan. And Brockton stayed home on it all, not selling out on the far side of the field, stayed near, able to jam him up just for a short gain, second down here. And boy, this is for all the marbles.
Second and goal from the 6. Sullivan under center. Pitch out this time to Graves, and he's going to be hit and spinning into the end zone, and that's a touchdown for the Trojans.
Unbelievable effort there. And
gave Patrick Gregory a ride.
That's not an easy thing to accomplish.
No, that's quite a feat by itself. Big number 79.
Yeah, and then talking to the referee, too, it's like, you know what? Patrick Gregory just, I understand the emotions are there, but you got to try and keep a cool head. It's difficult in these times, especially in such a heated game after, you know, you've been up the entire time. BR scores in OT, but Brockton, they're going to have a chance. That's the way these rules work.
I don't exactly know if I agree with this call going for two. I understand that you want to try and get the win in the first overtime, but I'm a guy that's always been a fan of getting the sure thing, and the extra point, 7-point lead, make Brockton try and force a second overtime.
Well, Sullivan back to pass. He cuts out. He's got a wide open run to the end zone, and he's in for two.
That's why you don't listen to me.
That puts the pressure on Brockton. They now need a touchdown and a 2-point conversion to tie and hope to get to a second go at it.
Corey Sullivan, that's almost an ice in your veins type of moment right there. In overtime, you take the ball on the QB keep. You have about 2 or 3 Brockton Boxers trailing on you. Knows that really. You just need the ball to break the plane. You don't need to worry about the feet as much. And he gets a touchdown. And just like that, Brockton, you're up next.
We're going to see all the big guns. Thomas O'Brien, Sean King coming off the field. At least momentarily. Edmund Kelsey, Devel Gomes.
This is quite the
surprise. Keyshawn Brown's not in there. He's been the surprise offensive talent for the Boxers, listed as a defensive back, but he's had some really big plays on offense when it really counts.
I would say this is Edmund Kelsey's overtime at this point. He brought the Boxers into the scoring drive with that big 70-plus yard run. I'd say just give him the ball and see what happens.
No receiver set. The Trojans stack in the box. The give to Kelsey. He heads right up the middle, and he gets to about the 6.5. And a scrum after the play.
And that time it's Corey Smith, 78 and 79, really mixing it up here with the BR Trojans after the whistle. And it's all well and good, but you got to be careful not to get a stupid personal foul penalty here and really back your team up.
And at this point, you don't need a stupid penalty like this when your running back just ran the ball for 2 yards. You don't need to set him back to the 13-yard line or even further back. Just see what happens. I mean, you have a great running back, Edmund Kelsey. Don't try and hurt his cause by throwing a Trojans player on the ground.
Absolutely. That would just be the worst possible thing you could ask for if you're a coach in overtime.
Same set for the Boxers. O'Brien under center. Nishoku Deke will end up as the only tight end. Give to Kelsey, and he gets to the 4 this time, so it'll be 3rd and goal from the 4 for Brockton, and I think they're going to get in on this one.
Definitely like the Trojans lining up very heavy on the front line. You don't want to give up an extra yard at this point, but having those secondary players come in sort of provide a little bit of a push if you have a battle of the trenches, try and set the ball back a little bit more.
You know, it's not a conventional strategy, but I think you line Edmund Kelsey up with a few big guys behind him just to push the pile. Gomes and Kelsey behind O'Brien. No receivers for the Boxers. Give to Kelsey, and he's in. Touchdown, Brockton, and gonna have a finish. It comes down to a two-point conversion.
It will. This is going to be unbelievable. Edmund Kelsey doing the work, the great work that he has done all day, just willing this Boxers team into this position. And now it just comes down to a two-point conversion, and this is where that rush by Corey Sullivan looms very, very large. It puts a ton of pressure on the Boxers because the first time around they would have had the opportunity to just kick the extra point if BR had done the same. And now we get some people on the field trying to hype the stands up, trying to get some noise going for this Boxers team. And the band's going to help them out.
Everyone's on their feet here at Marciano Stadium. 13-15, the Boxers going for the two-point conversion. No receivers. Brockton's going to call it. BR's going to call a timeout, rather. Devel Gomes and Edmund Kelsey had been lined up as the two backs.
I'm just saying, this might go down as one of the best Thanksgiving games between these two teams. The first six
hands
years
down,
have been duds, essentially, when you compare it to this.
Non-contest, yep. And now we have an OT game where a two-point conversion is hanging in the balance late. And, boy, you know what? I take back what I said. I will put turkey, mashed potatoes, and sweet potato pie on hold willingly for the moment for this exciting overtime action.
We all know it's not you doing the cooking anyway. It's poor old Mrs. Convey.
Well, that's how we help our families. We stay out of the house. That way we
just
go in there.
Yeah, give them all the extra room to get done.
Table set, dinner set. We just go in and eat. But certainly a treat here on Thanksgiving watching these two teams in this game. A game where BR looked flat, really, for the first three quarters. It was that run by Devontae Graves in the fourth quarter that really boosted BR's ego up to this point now, where they're a two-point conversion stop away from winning this game.
Well, get in, and we have a second go-round for the Brockton Boxers. Don't get in. This game's over, and BR takes the win. To give to Edmund Kelsey, and is he in? It's going to be close. No sign yet.
They're
BR calling
no.
for it, and no, BR takes the win.
It's almost like flashbacks to the Super Bowls a few years ago when the BR Trojans faced off against Brockton. On the fourth try, there was a touchdown. This time, no conversion, no win. Trojans walk off on Turkey Day.
And Bryce Shaw gets absolutely bundled by one of his teammates in celebration. And just an unbelievable win for BR. They stood up on the crucial two-point conversion, both on offense and then on defense. They were able to convert on the offensive end with Corey Sullivan. Bryce Shaw in the middle in the mix once again. Rubenskis there as well. And the Trojans stand up, finish their season on a high note. And for the Brockton Boxers, just another reason for them to be motivated going into next season. They're going to get Joel Montero back. They're going to get Edmund Kelsey back. They're going to have an extremely good team. They are graduating some tough seniors, but you can bet the coaching staff for Brockton High will have their kids ready to go once again next year.
Connor Rigo gets the stop on that play, and this is the first time BR's come from behind all season long, so leave it to this point in this game for them to come from behind. So Connor Rigo gets the stop and gets the play of the game, essentially, on what would have been the tying two-point conversion. And at first glance, it looked like he actually got into the end zone, but obviously you can go back and watch the replays and see that he obviously didn't get in the end zone.
Well, it's Rigo with the play of the day for the Bridgewater-Raynham Trojans, who now move to a solid 6-1 on Turkey Day against the Brockton Boxers. And Brockton, a very heartbroken team here on senior day at Marciano Stadium. And Bridgewater's taking it to them.
I mean, the BR Trojans facing off against the Brockton Boxers. At first glance, the Brockton Boxers, they are a Division I football team. And BR, they're a borderline Division I, Division I-A football team. I mean, coming into this game, you looked at the Brockton Boxers linemen both offensively and defensively, and they had some size on the BR Trojans, but BR, the smaller, the shorter players that they are, give credit to them. They found a way to get through all the open holes. I go back to that touchdown over and over again because that was the turning point. Sean Knoll taking out the spy back and allowing Devontae Graves to go to the near side numbers.
And perhaps even bigger than that, the call by head coach Dan Buron going against the expertise of John Luck.
Oh, there's a reason he's been the coach for 20-plus years, and I just get to sit up here with a turkey hat near me.
Absolutely. What a game, boys. Just an unbelievable contest between two very physical teams. A Thanksgiving game to remember, certainly the best in this rivalry of the Cape Cod Pizza Bowl. And good stuff here on Thanksgiving 2016.
Now, the annual trophy presentation down at the 50-yard line led by John and Paul Marion.
At this point, the question becomes, who do you give the MVP to of this game for the BR Trojans, as there were a few players you can obviously hand it off to.
The valuable player of the game for the BR Trojans, Edmund Kelsey from the Brockton Boxers, as the
no
Trojans
surprises there.
The Trojans get set to receive the Cape Cod Cafe Cup once again. They are the six-time Cup champions, as the captains get set to accept.
Yeah, just an unbelievable effort from both of those guys. I mean, giving their heart and soul. Sean Noel played extremely well for the Trojans. And on the other side, Thomas O'Brien managing the game extremely well. Saw some contributions from Devel Gomes, Sean King, Kingsley Jogo, DK. I mean, enough cannot be said about the defensive effort that he put in today. Keyshawn Brown coming up big in the second half with a couple of huge hits. Brockton, you know what? It will be a tale of just not converted. They likely could have put the Trojans out in the beginning of the second half if they had converted even one of those two fumble recoveries. They couldn't do it. They let BR hang around, and ultimately, a very strong, scrappy, physical team, and BR was able to get it done.
Brockton had two consecutive third downs in that second half that you're talking about where they couldn't convert. If you convert on one of those drives, we're already on the way home down 24. But give credit to Brockton. This was a very great effort put forth by the Brockton Boxers after losing the game against Wellesley the way they did. A lot of people didn't know if this was going to be a defeated team coming out. But obviously, this team came in for a fight, and they went the extra round going into overtime. But we couldn't see on our monitor, but what we're being told is that two-point conversion play, that handoff, the back was just about on the side or just about on the goal line. So it was literally a game of inches that Brockton almost took home the Cape Cod Cafe Cup.
So Brockton moves on from the starting quarterback, Matt Caruso, Thomas O'Brien, and the rest of the 23 seniors on this team. They've got a tough year rebuilding, but Edmund Kelsey, who is the MVP on the Brockton side for this Cape Cod Cafe Bowl, is going to have a strong senior season, Amy.
He definitely is, and they will get Jose Montero Jr. back as well. And so the Brockton Boxers offense could potentially be in quite good position next year. We will just have to see. They're going to lose a lot of leadership on defense, that of Keyshawn Brown and Kingsley Ejogo Dike, as we've spoken about a number of times. But having Edmund Kelsey come back, maintaining a decent offensive and defensive line presence, I really think it's going to bode well for this team going into next season.
Well, Brittany Mahan is with victorious head coach Dan Buron. And what does coach have to say, Brittany?
So he's been a coach for 24 years. It always feels good to get a Thanksgiving win. What was special about today's win?
Well, it was special for the seniors. They're a great group of kids. We've had a great year, and some tough losses. And I wanted to go out on top. And, we didn't have a great first half, but you got to credit Brockton. They they really ran the ball down our throats. But at halftime, we made some adjustments, I thought. Just challenged the kids to come out and play hard, and they did. And it was just two good teams going at it today.
Knowing that it's Thanksgiving, and obviously a lot of people have a lot of stuff going on, what makes, besides the seniors, what makes it so special about today?
Well, you see a lot of former players, a lot of people come out for this game, and we're thankful for that. And it's just the seniors' last game. As a group, it's our last game together. So it's just special, you know, and there's a little more. It's pride you got all year now, and we're not in the playoffs. So, you know, these seniors remember this the rest of their lives.
What did your seniors bring to this team for your future players?
They brought incredible leadership. They just, from day one, they worked hard. It's been a special group. They had some adversity early on in the year, and they overcame that. And their work ethic. For the younger guys, if they can follow in the footsteps of these seniors, then, you know, Bridgewater-Raynham is in good shape for a long time to come. This is a very special group to me. And it means a lot, but it's just their work ethic. Every came to practice every day, worked hard. Every game, we played a tough schedule. Every game, they played hard right till the end, and today was no exception.
Coach, happy Thanksgiving, and congratulations on a win.
Thanks, Brittany. John, your final thoughts on yet another Bridgewater-Raynham Thanksgiving Day win.
I mean, pretty soon, this is going to be like a lineup in the budget, taking care of the Cape Cod Cafe Cup. But nevertheless, this has been a great effort put forth by the BR Trojans. This year as a whole, you look at the performances of Sean Old Jr., Corey Sullivan. A lot of people didn't think that Corey Sullivan would be the passing quarterback that he turned into. And ironically enough, it was a two-point conversion that won the game, the running into the end zone with two people trailing on him. But you heard Coach mention it, the tough schedule taking on Duxbury, Xavarian, St. John's Prep, the playoff run, three straight road playoff games. Certainly a great season put forth by BR Trojan that culminates here today at Marciano Stadium.
Well, Mad Dog, and again, as we spoke about, another good season for the Brockton Boxers, of course, ending in defeat to BC High. Their playoff run did a very difficult team, one of the Catholic powerhouses in the area. And, of course, they wanted to come out on Thanksgiving and get a Cape Cod Bowl victory. BR just continuing their dominance in this rivalry. As John Luck wags a finger at me.
Not much of a rivalry.
We're going to get him next year. The Brockton Boxers, again, had a great season. They played their hearts out today. Of course, tough loss, 13-15. They're able to score late. Can't punch it in for two. A lot of seniors graduating, but a lot of talent coming back. And we'll see what the next season holds.
We want to thank all of the crew, Bridgewater Television, Brockton Community Access, the semi-annual every single Thanksgiving, and a few extra shoots every year. Tag Team Production, on behalf of executive producers Jeff Fowler, Mark Lindy, the entire broadcast team at BTV BCA, my broadcast partners, Newby Ratto, Brittany Mahan on the sidelines, up in the booth, John Luck, aiming Showtime Convey. I'm Mad Dog Matt Nelson, and we'll see you next year for the 8th edition and hopefully a Brockton win. And happy Thanksgiving.